Good morning and welcome to the 9th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2023. Today we have apologies from Monica Lennon and Ash Regan, and I'd like to welcome Colette Stevenson, and Mercedes Villalba will be attending I think slightly later as a substitute. When Mercedes Villalba joins us, I will have to just take a pause to ask her if she wants to make a declaration before she makes any questions in the committee, because that technically is the first item on the agenda. That will come at the correct moment. So we'll move on to agenda item two, which is a decision on taking business in private. And that is, we have consideration whether to take items 6, 7, and 8 in private. Items 6 and 7 are in to consider the evidence we have heard today in relation to the outcome of COP15 and Scotland's deposit return scheme. Item 8 is a consideration of the draft report on the UK Energy Bill. Do we agree to take these items in private?
Yes.
We are agreed, so we will take items 6, 7 and 8 in private. So agenda item 3 now is the outcomes of COP15. This is an evidence session as part of our scrutiny on the outcomes of the 15th UN Biodiversity Conference, otherwise known as COP15. Members have received papers in relation to this. Last week, the committee heard from a panel of experts in biodiversity policy. This week, we'll hear from the Scottish Government on its views on the outcomes of COP15 and how the targets agreed at the summit will be embedded in the new Scottish Biodiversity Strategy. I'd like to welcome Lorna Slater, the Minister for Green Skills, Circular Economy and Biodiversity. Thank you for attending today. I'd also like to welcome Matthew Bird, who's the Biodiversity Team Leader, and Lisa McCann, who is the Head of Biodiversity for the Scottish Government. Before we begin, Minister, I believe you'd like to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for inviting me here today to discuss the outcomes from COP15 and how we are integrating those into our biodiversity strategy. I know you have already heard overwhelming evidence about the extent of the biodiversity crisis that we're facing here in Scotland and across the world, and the importance of taking action now to tackle this decline in nature. I know you have also heard about the historic Kunming-Montreal Global Biodiversity Framework, which was agreed at the end of last year. That framework builds on a vision that I hope you share of the world living in harmony with nature, where by 2050, biodiversity is valued, conserved, restored, and wisely used, maintaining ecosystem services. As you are aware, I was honoured to attend COP15 with a small Scottish delegation, which culminated in presenting the Edinburgh Declaration to that conference's high-level segment on behalf of subnational bodies. As well as calling for a high ambition outcome from the meeting in Montreal, the Edinburgh Declaration also called for the critical role that subnational bodies play in addressing the biodiversity crisis to be recognised and allocated the resources and powers necessary to help tackle it. I was delighted that the Declaration was adopted at the conference and now forms part of the new Global Biodiversity Framework. The Scottish Government led the Edinburgh process at the request of the Convention on Biological Diversity's Secretariat, and I am very proud of the work that was done to promote and draw support for it. That work is demonstrated by the fact that at the final count, it had been signed by over 300 subnational bodies from around the world. Our draft biodiversity strategy was published to coincide with COP15, but remained in draft to allow us to take into account the new global biodiversity framework and ensure that we are meeting that global ambition. The strategy is where we set out our high-level vision for a nature-positive Scotland and our ambition to halt biodiversity loss by 2030 and reverse declines by 2045. I have often wondered if this is ambitious enough, but while there has been a huge amount of really positive activity across Scotland in recent years, for example, our scaling up of peatland restoration, our groundbreaking Nature Restoration Fund, it is clear that there is still a huge amount of work to do. The type of change that we need to see does take time, which is why it's even more important to start taking action now. So we are currently refining the strategy and are now very focused on developing the delivery plans that will sit underneath the strategy. as these will be where we set out how we are going to achieve our high-level vision and outcomes. I was very grateful to the committee, yourselves, for the careful and detailed consideration that you gave to the draft biodiversity strategy last year. Your comments formed an important part of our consideration in developing the strategy, and as I set out when I wrote to the committee in December, many of these points were incorporated into the final draft. We are also starting to explore the next steps in implementing the Edinburgh Declaration with our subnational partners and how best we can work together to really deliver on the new global framework. I'm really welcoming this discussion today and I appreciate the attention that the committee is giving to this important matter.
Thank you very much, Minister. And I'm now just going to do a pivot, which politicians sometimes are quite capable of doing, and go back to pause the meeting in your section and go back to agenda item one, which is, as Mercedes Villalba, it's the first time you've attended the committee. I'd like to ask if there are any declarations that you'd like to make before asking any questions at the committee. So, Mercedes, are there any declarations you wish to make?
Thank you. I don't have any relevant interest to declare.
Thank you very much. And we'll now pivot back again to the subject in hand. And thank you, Minister, for that opening statement. And I'd like to come back to the first questions on this subject, which are from Jackie Dunbar. Jackie.
Good morning, and good morning, Minister. The new global framework requires us to take urgent action to halt and reverse the biodiversity loss. And we heard last week that given that we've now got ambitious targets for 2030, which is only 7 years away, that's only like seven growing seasons we were hearing last week, and that there's going to be like a need for speed. How can this urgency be realised in Scotland? What do we need to do in this Parliament session for this to be on track and remain on track?
That is an excellent question, because the member's right, we need to start early to make sure that we have the impact in the timescale that we need. I think of this work as being done in two streams. There's the stream of the urgent actions that we are already taking and that we now need to scale up, things like our Nature Restoration Fund, things like the peatland restoration, which we have started and we are, you know, world leaders in, but we know we need to scale up. And then the biodiversity strategy, which represents that longer term vision to 2045 and the actions that we need to take there, which I'm sure, as the member would agree, need to be joined up, need to be across government, need to be across all sectors of society, land use, agriculture, and so on. But I'm happy to go through in detail some of the things that we're doing right now to urgently tackle the nature crisis. So we are scaling up our peatland restoration rates with the aim of restoring 250,000 hectares of degraded peat by 2030. Our groundbreaking £65 million Nature Restoration Fund is providing multi-year funding to drive restoration at scale. We've recently approved grants which include funding to Cairngorms Connect to restore natural rivers and floodplains in the Inch Marshes, and to the Argyll and Islands Coast and Countryside Trust to restore Argyll's Atlantic rainforest. In October last year, we announced a new package of Scottish Government support totalling over £2.9 million to focus on conservation, research and connecting people with nature, aiming to accelerate the response to the biodiversity and climate crisis. This included £1.3 million to restore Scotland's rainforest, £500,000 for the five-year Species on the Edge partnership project, £200,000 to the Green Action Trust to support their work with local communities to create and restore woodlands. We have created over 10,000 hectares of new woodland in the past year, with 42% of that being native species. As well as this investment, we're ensuring biodiversity is embedded in our policies with our new vision for agriculture, which aims to make Scotland a global leader in sustainable and regenerative agriculture with nature and climate at its heart. We have committed to highly protect 10% of our marine areas, and our new national planning framework signals a turning point for planning with responding to the global climate emergency and nature crisis central to its objectives.
Okay. You spoke there about the Scottish biodiversity list. Will these be reviewed moving forward?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. And who would be taking the lead on that? You know, government and also maybe within other partners?
This matter in terms of recovering and protecting vulnerable and important species is one of the five themes that is covered by the biodiversity strategy. So the biodiversity strategy has 26 actions that we are taking for nature, and they are grouped into five themes. Theme four is to recover and protect vulnerable species, and one of those is to revise the Scottish Biodiversity List of Species and Habitats that Scottish ministers consider to be of importance for biodiversity conservation in Scotland. And perhaps Matthew or Lisa can add some detail on that process.
The process will be led by Nature Scott in consultation with probably our group of stakeholders who we work closely with in developing the strategy and delivery plan. So Nature Scott obviously have a scientific advisory committee, and they will prepare papers for, together with stakeholders, making recommendations for the relevant species, which will be put to the Scientific Advisory Committee and ultimately to ministers for agreement.
Okay.
Sorry, Matthew, you mentioned stakeholders. Could you give me an indication of who those are? Are they statutory bodies, non-statutory bodies, charities?
Sure. There's a Scottish Biodiversity Programme which oversees the work we do to produce the strategy and the delivery plan. And in support of that, there's both an advisory group which comprises external academics from a wide range of sources, and a stakeholder engagement group which includes about 75 different representatives, so a wide range of NGOs, also academics, and representatives from the statutory public bodies and so on.
Okay. It'd be helpful just to see who's on that list. I'd be interested to see. So maybe after the committee meeting, you could drop a line to the clerk of who that would be. Jackie, is that you finished? Because I thought I'd go to Liam next.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you.
Liam.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Minister. the draft Scottish Biodiversity Strategy, you said, was published in draft so that it could be updated following COP15 and the GBF. Now that we're ahead of those, what areas do you think need to be strengthened in the draft strategy as a result of those COP15 outcomes?
Overall, there is very clear alignment between the Kunming-Montreal Global Biodiversity Framework and our draft Scottish Biodiversity Strategy, including 30 by 30 protections. Our analysis is that the strategy either already matches or exceeds the ambition in the global framework. The Scottish Biodiversity Strategy has increased ambition compared to the Global Biodiversity Framework, as the completion date for our targets is 2030 and delivery of the vision is 2045, considered compared to 2050 with the Global Framework. So the goals and targets in the Global Biodiversity Framework are global goals, and not all of them can be directly translated to a national context. It is the job of our biodiversity strategy and delivery plan to set out what we will need to do in Scotland to contribute in meeting those global goals, but we will publish the comparison between our goals and the global goals within that final document.
And when do you anticipate the delivery strategy and the delivery plans to be finalised?
So the strategy will be finalised first, and then the delivery plan will come after that. Perhaps Matthew has timelines for that.
Sure. So we anticipate that there will be a further round of consultation in late spring, early summer, for both the strategy and the delivery plan together. That will then need to undergo a period of analysis of the responses to the consultation, and we'll be looking to publish both together as a package in late summer, early autumn.
Thank you. So, late summer, for something that the committee heard last week, we have now less than 7 years for the targets. And one of the things that concerned me following Jackie Dunbar's questions, we're obviously talking about delivery plans, but we surely can't meaningfully make delivery plans unless the strategy is finalised. And Minister, you then went on to list a huge number of very impressive investments that the Scottish Government is making in biodiversity, but there's no strategy underlying it, and there won't be for at least another 6 months. So that, I might reflect back and say, that means you're funding a whole load of things without a strategy as to why you're funding them. Is that a fair criticism, Minister?
I think that where the member is maybe in a different sort of framework here than I'm looking at is the actions that we're taking now are well-evidenced actions. We know, for example, that restoration of peatland has excellent results for biodiversity as well as for carbon sequestration. All the actions that we are taking are evidence, and the things like the Nature Restoration Fund are going into very practical actions, such as restoring rivers, restoring wetlands, managing rhododendron in the rainforest. So we know that the actions that we are taking are effective. What we need to do with that strategy is join that up, get that mainstreaming piece across agriculture, across all the different sectors. And of course, that does take time and does require that stakeholder engagement so that we make sure that we get those pieces right and bring everybody along with us on that journey. But that doesn't mean that we haven't got started or that we have delayed action in these matters. And it doesn't mean that we're not using evidence to support the actions that we're deciding to take.
Thank you.
Thanks, Liam. Jackie, back to you.
Yes, following on from Liam, you were saying that you'd need to join actions together to make them work. I was hearing that just on Friday, declaring my interest as the parliamentary nature champion for sea trout. I had a meeting with the John Muir Trust and the Scottish Wildlife Trust going up the River Don, and they were telling me and explaining to me the problems that the sea trout has, because it goes from the sea right up the estuary and also, of course, needs the landscape for it to be able to breed, etc. So can I ask you what the plans are in holistic terms going forward, how we're going to bring it all together. And also I'm going to ask a very cheeky question as well. We have a strategy for wild salmon. Now, the brown trout and the sea trout, which are two different species, are very similar or the same life cycle as what the wild salmon. And so would you be thinking of bringing them in to the same strategy so that they're protected as well?
Before you make any comment on that, and because you brought this up, and last week I made a voluntary declaration of my register of interest that I own and manage land through my farming partnership. As you have mentioned salmon, a subject very close to my heart, it is right that I refer members to my interest in a wild salmon fishery on the River Spey, which I jointly own with my brother. Just so there's no dubiety, and I'm not asking the question, but Minister, sorry to interrupt your response, which was about to be forthcoming.
No problem. I'll tackle both of those ones for the member. So the Scottish Biodiversity Strategy does, tie in with other strategies, and it is essential that biodiversity considerations are mainstreamed to all of our policy development, which is one of our key aims. Given the breadth of matters dealt with government, there is, of course, a wide range of strategies and plans to address issues in particular sectors. The Biodiversity Strategy provides a clear vision and set of outcomes which all of our policies must help to achieve. The Environment Strategy for Scotland presents a whole-of-government approach to tackling the climate and nature crises by creating an overarching framework for Scotland's strategies and plans on the environment and climate change. Strengthening the connections between environmental policies and policies across government, it helps us identify priorities and opportunities and drive that transformative change that we need. So we know that healthy biodiversity underpins our prosperity, our well-being and our net zero. So that is so much, and I know this is something you guys are all aware of too, because of the evidence that you've taken, that we do need to mainstream this piece, that tackling biodiversity cannot be done in a silo. It needs to be done across all of society. Specifically about the wild salmon. So wild salmon are an indicator species. So things that we do to protect wild salmon will also protect other species, because as you say, species that either have similar lifestyles or share their natural environment. And as the members will know, as wild salmon are are in decline. So in response to those declining populations, in January of last year, we published Scotland's Wild Salmon Strategy, which was a collective vision for flourishing populations of wild Atlantic salmon, and we set a high level of ambition and direction of travel there. So we've set this up with, followed this up with an implementation plan, which was published last month, which sets out over 60 actions, which we'll be taking over the next 5 years to protect and restore salmon population. So these strategy and plan were developed in close collaboration with stakeholder groups, which include representatives from government, NGOs and agencies. And we are clear that positive outcomes can only be achieved through a coordinated and collaborative approach. Now, I've been lucky enough to go and visit some of the nature restoration work that's being done along some of the rivers, and things like removing weirs from the rivers, putting in where the weirs cannot be removed, putting in passes to allow the salmon past. But that, of course, would apply to other species as well. And there's a great project of river restoration where one of the problems we have with some rivers in Scotland is that they're sort of too clean. There's no trees along the banks. Yeah. There's nothing in the water. They run too fast and they run too clear and they run too hot because the sun shines on them all the time. So this particular project was taking fallen trees and embedding them in the river bed, so that not only does that slow the water, it creates shaded spots and eddies and stuff where fish can spawn, but also invertebrates can breed and so on. And that's the kind of practical on-the-ground action that Nature Restoration Fund is having an impact specifically to target those such important species.
Okay, thank you. And two notable targets for the Global Framework Agreement are the 30 by 30 target and, as you've mentioned, the restoration target. So for the restoration to be completed or underway by at least 30% of degraded terrestrial inland waters and coastal and marine ecosystems, what scale of challenge do these targets present for us here in Scotland, and what kind of programmes, I know you've just mentioned one, will we need moving forward?
That is such an interesting question. And when I was in Montreal speaking with people from around the world, other subnational governments, it's very interesting how different the challenge here is in Scotland from places like large countries in South America or parts of Canada, where to meet the 30 by 30, they can more or less kind of draw a line in a map and go, right, that's our 30%, we're done. And within this space, either no people live or only people live who live traditional indigenous lifestyles. And that's it. Their job is relatively easy. We have a different challenge here. All parts of Scotland are inhabited and are managed landscapes. So we cannot and would not be able to sort of remove or separate people from land in that way. So our challenge is actually quite an interesting one. So we need to find a way to do all the economic activities we currently do, farming, towns, our national parks, fishing, all these activities, but within a framework that allows us to be nature positive, to allow that nature regeneration. And in fact, I think that if we can do that, we set a model for the whole world, because we show how people and nature can live side by side and can thrive. And so this is why when we look at things like land reform, like the agricultural schemes, all of these things need to be looked at within that framework of restoring our biodiversity, of replacing what's lost and making sure that we are creating that abundant biodiversity. It is a really interesting challenge and one that's unique in some ways to Europe and to Scotland, where we have these highly managed landscapes. But it's an exciting one. It's something I'm actually hoping our national parks can play a particular role in, because of their unique position in the Scottish landscape. They can provide a place where we can pilot ideas of humans and nature living alongside one another, because we do have commercial forestry, we do have farming within our parks, which other countries, for example, don't have those kind of activities in their national parks. So yes, we do have an interesting challenge ahead of us, and it is quite unique, but it does mean that we can show the world how people and nature can live together.
I also think local authorities can help as well. I was hearing that in Aberdeen City, they've got a plan for, I think it's a million trees in the next 5 years. But also something that was interesting to me was the Denburn, which runs through the city centre. They straightened it many years ago, and flooding has occurred because of it. And now there are plans in place, I believe, that to try and get it back to what it originally was to help. So, sorry, I'm rambling a bit, Convener. That's me.
I was wondering when the question was coming, Jackie.
Further question, sorry.
That may have been a statement then, on that basis.
It was a comment.
Thank you. Moving to the next question, which will come from the Deputy Convener, Fiona Hislop.
Good morning, Minister. You've already talked about the need for mainstreaming, and we've already heard from other witnesses that there are a number of areas where biodiversity needs to be mainstreamed. There's opportunities in agricultural payments, the Land Reform Bill, the Circular Economy Bill, and reviews of forestry policy, to name but a few. So are you satisfied that the opportunities for nature recovery are being given the right level of priority in these areas?
I mean, I would always say that they always need more. Of course I would. I'm the Minister for Biodiversity, but I can certainly outline some of our vision in this area. The strategy, the biodiversity strategy, is a starting point. It sets out very clearly what we need to achieve to halt and reverse biodiversity loss. It also provides us with the evidence that human activity has accelerated biodiversity decline. So the member's quite right. Biodiversity does need to be mainstreamed across all our policy developments, our business practices, and across wider society. This isn't something that government can do on our own. Nature doesn't belong to us. Nature belongs to everybody. That's every business, every person. So I'm working closely with other ministers to make sure that our collective policies will deliver the positive outcomes we need to see. And some good examples of this are our National Strategy for Economic Transformation, which for the first time recognises the importance of our natural capital as an asset to the country that we need to maintain. Our Vision for Agriculture puts nature restoration at its heart, alongside climate mitigation and food security, recognising the importance of that sector in delivering for biodiversity, and that farmers and land managers are stewards of our land. And I think quite interestingly, our National Planning Framework, NPF4, and its supporting guidance, which has significantly greater emphasis on the importance of conserving our natural environment. I've actually got an excerpt from it here, which is called Developing with Nature Guidance, which is for anyone who's making a planning application. And it's got very clear and quite practical steps that people can take. So in terms of taking account of nature when you're putting in place a planning application, to apply the mitigation hierarchy, to consider biodiversity from the outset, to take a place-based and inclusive process. It has practical things here like what plants are suitable for pollinators, how to plant a wildflower meadow, what trees in scrub and woodland, and how they can be incorporated into developments. So this is a really good example of mainstreaming, that anyone applying for a planning permission for a development in Scotland has access to all this information, how to incorporate homes for bees and bugs, for example, into their development planning, and how to manage nature with water, for example. So I think that's an excellent example of mainstreaming that will make a difference as we go forward.
So the first time that nature capital was put in an economic recovery plan wasn't the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. It was actually in the COVID economic recovery plan that was published in 2020, which is actually almost three years ago. So I'd be interested in what action had been taken in those, dare I say, 2.5 years, as opposed to the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. But moving on, in terms of mainstreaming, there's more obvious areas that we've talked about. We know that most government agencies and departments understand the need for embedding net zero, because that's one of our crises, but clearly biodiversity is another of the twin crises, is the other crisis. So what understanding do you have of the level, comparison, if you compare it to net zero, in terms of embedding that as a mainstream activity, do you think exists in other agencies? And are there forums that you bring together different public agencies to discuss what they're doing to tackle nature loss and biodiversity? How does it work in areas that are not so obvious?
I think the member is quite right that kind of globally there seems to be a good understanding, and has been for quite a long time, of the climate crisis in terms of carbon emissions and reaching net zero. But there has been a maybe slower grasping that the nature crisis is hand in hand with that, and actually is part of how we're going to tackle that. I think within the Scottish Government we've made some really good progress there in understanding how biodiversity fits in and how that natural capital fits in across the piece. And you can see that, for example, not only the things that I've outlined already here in terms of our National Strategy for Economic Transformation, our national planning, the agriculture vision, but also in things like our circular economy bill and the work we're doing in circular economy. So much of that is the answer to the how. If your problem is that you've got plastics in your oceans, and I was meeting a stakeholder the other week who said that we have evidence that the otters that live in the water of Leith, otter kits, consume plastics with their first meal that they ever take because the food that they eat is in fact has plastic in it. If that's your problem, then your solution is to take that plastic out of the environment, that plastic waste, and to make it more circular. So I think you can see that everything that we're doing, from deposit return scheme right through to our national planning framework, is considering biodiversity. And I'm really pleased that we're making those steps. I think that that's the right direction. But as Minister for Biodiversity, I will always say we can do more.
And can I just maybe finally ask, is there some kind of forum that you bring together all ministers on biodiversity, nature loss at any point? Does that happen?
I mean, it's incorporated. There are many forums for this. The two things are now incorporated together, the climate emergency and the nature emergency together. So they are considered. There's a variety of different forums for that. There's the subcommittee on the climate emergency, which is meeting this morning. Unfortunately, I'm obviously here and not there. And then the First Minister's Environmental Council is another good forum for that, where ministers attend, but also experts from the field.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. Mercedes, you're up next. Fiona, if you want to come in on the back of this, then we'll see.
It was a supplementary on Fiona's question. Is that okay to go to that first?
A supplementary on
Fiona's question around
mainstreaming. Yes, absolutely.
Okay?
While
we're on the topic of mainstreaming, and the land reform bill was mentioned, and it's accepted that Scotland's got an unusually concentrated pattern of land ownership. And I know that the Scottish Government has expressed a desire for more diverse patterns of rural land ownership. And so I wondered if you could explain how addressing that concentration of land ownership can improve biodiversity and nature restoration, and if you've got any best practice examples that you could share of nature restoration taking place through publicly owned land, whether that's councils or public bodies.
Yeah, absolutely. On the second point, the things like rural regional land use partnerships and also the national parks do incorporate that working of different land managers and different, you know, different business models and ownership models together to do the nature restoration, the land management. The best example of that is the Cairngorms Connect, which is globally recognised, which is a mix of public and private land to work together to do that regeneration within our national park. In terms of the land reform, the member is quite right. Land reform is part of the toolkit there to address the ownership patterns, but also, which is part of the Scottish Government's policy, but also I think that there is some good work being done as we move towards our land reform bill on how that can work for nature. So I went with Ms. McCallan when she did her roadshow on the land reform bill, and that meant that I got to hear firsthand from stakeholders around land reform and what their hopes and dreams are in terms of that supporting biodiversity. So where the purpose of that land reform bill is to, you know, where there's a public interest to facilitate and help that land go into the community ownership, particularly where it's for the common good around things like nature. But a key part of that is the land management plans, which I'm very much hoping we can use as a tool to make sure that land is managed well and that biodiversity is intended absolutely to be part of that, so that we have responsible land ownership and can, you know, help move the dial toward responsible land ownership around the country, because I know there's already some really good examples of that.
Thank you. I'll move on to the next question. So the new global framework agreement requires that all land is to be under participatory integrated biodiversity, inclusive spatial planning and or effective management processes addressing land and sea use change. So I'm interested in how the Scottish Government interprets that requirement and what that requirement means in practice in terms of land use spatial planning.
Yeah, I'm happy to answer that one. So spatial planning, both terrestrial and marine, is about balancing these competing interests so that we make sure that we have obviously a thriving economy and thriving nature alongside it. And it's clear that the balance between competing interests in the past has been wrong, to the serious detriment of our natural environment. And our strategy is really clear that our high-level goals of a nature positive by 2030 and substantially restoring nature by 2045 will require this whole-of-society approach. In terms of specific areas around spatial planning in the marine space, the Scotland's National Marine Plan provides the guiding framework for decision-making in the sustainable management of marine activities and resources in Scotland's waters. So I might hand to Lisa and Matthew to come into some more detail on the spatial planning in both those spaces.
Yep, so I think MPF4 also provides the overarching framework for how we use our land, and as the Minister just outlined, provides some high-level ambition for biodiversity. I'm not a marine expert, but as the Minister has outlined, the marine plan is also where we set out that overarching framework. And I think the Blue Economy Vision, which has also recently been published, provides a synergy with that marine plan, which helps ensure that planning in marine areas provides the outcomes that we're seeking for biodiversity.
And in terms of balancing those interests, obviously on land and at sea, you've got requirement for food as well as energy. On land, you've also got housing. What practical steps are you taking to ensure that all those different interests and interests are being balanced, and that no one's kind of misses out in order for us to reach our targets?
Yeah, so you've identified three very important areas there: food, energy and housing. And this is exactly the kind of mainstreaming piece that we're looking at with reform of the agricultural subsidies that is as I've laid out, to deal with environmental matters as well as food security. So the idea is that these aren't necessarily competing interests, that actually I think agriculture is part of the solution to the climate crisis, and that regenerative farming and crofting has such an important role to play on how we do this and while that sector thrives. So those matters, I think, are dealt with under both land reform and the agricultural reform. Energy and housing would be matters under the National Planning Framework, which, as we've outlined, has really clear guidance on having biodiversity built right in, as well as specific guidance on both national development and that development guidance that I've just outlined there. So in those areas, I think we are well covered for biodiversity.
Thank you.
Thank you. Back to Fiona.
Clearly, MPF4, with its hierarchy, does put biodiversity in a far stronger place than it has been previously. And that's obviously for land use change for planning. But for existing land, that land use management has been happening for generations. That stewardship of land has been happening very, very well in many places. And I am concerned when we hear about this idea of competing interests. And I was interested in what you were talking about in terms of that shared interest, because I think that must be the solution. If it's a mixed market solution, which is, yes, there'll be some public or community lands, but most of these lands are in private hands. So how is that going to work in practice? And you talked about the Cairngorm Connect, which when we were in Iceland at the Arctic Circle Assembly was being showcased as a really good example of how this could be done. Is that the model you'd hope to be used elsewhere, or is it going to be different solutions in different parts of the country, depending on that kind of one land use ownership, but also use of the land? Maybe you could explain a bit more how you see this working in practice.
Absolutely. I mean, our land is such a mosaic that there absolutely is not one solution anywhere or everywhere that would be suitable. The Cairngorm Connect is a very successful project, but that is, one project. Private land, of course, is owned for many uses, including farming, including all forestry, all the businesses that we do in Scotland. So this is why we need to make sure that we are looking at these across the piece. So we're looking at, how the agricultural subsidies can be reformed to support agriculture. We're looking at, minor adjustments to the Grousemoor legislation to ensure that those are managed well. We're, looking at how we can improve public transport and all the pieces across the board. So there isn't a one-size-fits-all for how land will be managed. It's about making sure that each sector and each indeed individual farmer, crofter and land manager has the tools available to them, that they know how to apply for the right grants and the right support so that they can manage their land the way that's right for their land. I mean, the landowners know what they need and what to do. So I guess I see our role in sort of facilitating and signpointing, saying, well, Here's the Nature Restoration Fund. Here's how you get the agricultural subsidies that will allow you to do what you need. Here's how you apply for forestry grant schemes. And all of these things together both incentivize land use toward biodiversity, but also mean that the land managers have those choices to make so they can look at their land and decide what is best for them and what's going to work for them.
Just finally, what is the biggest challenge to make that work effectively?
I think there's quite a lot of challenges there. Some of it is helping people understand what their options are, because there may be this is how I've always managed my land, I don't want to change, and that's fine too. But there's also, here's what's available to you. If you did want to manage your land differently, speaking to the head of the Deer Management Group, the Association for Deer Managers, he said to me, for example, you know, the way that things are currently set up, he can't have fewer than 12,000 sheep, but no more than 1,400 deer. And he says that to him, that doesn't make sense. That isn't necessarily how he would like to manage his land, but that's how the current system means he needs to manage his land. So I think part of this is putting different tools in place so that land managers like him are not sort of feeling obliged to overstock, for example, with sheep, that they can have a more of a mosaic even on their own land.
Okay, thank you.
Just following up on that a bit, if I may, Minister, it wasn't many years ago that we saw vast tracts of Aberdeenshire countryside, which was good arable land, being bought up and planted in trees, which was done because the grants were such that it encouraged tree planting and discouraged agriculture. And we've seen bits of Scotland planted in wind turbines, if that's the right description for it. And I think I looked at the figures in 2021 for the deaths of birds of prey, and I think there were, if I remember rightly, it was something like four buzzards, four sea eagles and eight ospreys that were chopped up by turbines just recorded. So we can't use land for all purposes. It has to be more a zonal approach, as you've indicated in the Cairngorms. What works in the Cairngorms may not work elsewhere. Has the government considered doing a more zonal approach to land use? Because land is the finite resource, the uses aren't.
I think it's important to remember with the member's comment that the biggest threat to wildlife, to birds, is actually climate change. And when you get colony collapse and so on, where you have thousands of individual birds or colonies collapsing down to only a few members from tens of thousands, that is due to climate change. So that is the biggest threat to birds. And of course, our energy transition is an important part of how we protect all species, including birds.
Minister, just before you go on, I would just say, one of the biggest threats to birds at the moment, some people may argue, is avian flu. But I understand in the long term it may be climate change. Sorry, just put that on record.
So in terms of the pattern of land ownership in Scotland, as the member knows, is largely with private hands. And of course, private landowners have the right to manage their land as they see fit. And it is, you know, with the Scottish Government to use incentives and guidelines and so on to try and ensure that that land is managed as best as possible towards Scottish Government goals. But of course, privately owned land is the concern of the person who owns it.
Yeah, I was suggesting a zonal approach. I wasn't talking about land ownership. A zonal approach is not limited by who owns the land. It's on how you direct the support and the grants and encourage people to carry out activities on that land. That's something the Scottish Government can do, isn't it?
I don't know if we have any comment on that.
I think you're absolutely right, Convener. One of the key commitments that the Scottish Government's made is to deliver nature networks. We're absolutely clear that those need to be driven by local agreements and through local forums and the development of local forums, and for local authorities to use their sort of convening powers to bring those partnerships together and identify, you know, the proper land uses in the proper places. So, you know, the right tree in the right place is a key part of the UK forestry strategy and the Scottish forestry strategy. And it's a shame to hear about that Aberdeenshire experience. But
So pushing back on that, Minister, right tree, right place, right crop, right place. It indicates a zonal approach. Are you in favour of a zonal approach?
I mean, that the phrase a zonal approach isn't something that's come across my desk, but in terms of making sure that communities and the local, you know, the local communities are involved, that is absolutely so important, because any investment in natural capital, we absolutely have to empower local communities. We can't have that just transition where we're imposing things on communities. It needs to absolutely come from them. And I mean, the member's right that we do need to consider the issue of who is benefiting from land and how we invest in it. But yeah, I mean, I'm happy to take that away and consider it.
Thank you, and I'm happy to meet with you to discuss it, Minister, if you so wish. Liam, I think you wanted to come in.
Yes, thanks, Convener. I'd like to take on some of the questions that we've just heard about funding and investment, if I may, and particularly the Deputy Convener brought up farming. And I noticed that there's a funding-related commitment in the draft strategy to shift half of all funding for farming and crofting from unconditional to conditional support by 2025. Minister, how much is half of all funding? What are the likely new conditions that farmers will have to meet? And is a lead time of presumably less than 18 months from finalisation long enough for farmers and crofters to adjust?
This is, as the member knows, ongoing work on agricultural reform to implement that commitment for 50% and the conditionality around it. I believe the Cabinet Secretary made an initial announcement a couple of weeks ago to the national annual meeting of the Farming Union on the direction of travel there, but that is a matter of ongoing consultation with the stakeholders to make sure we get those right, because the number one thing is that we need to make sure that 50% is not only delivering for biodiversity, but it's practical and workable and accessible for farmers and land managers, so they can get that money in a way that supports their business models.
I understand that, and I understand it's a complex question, but it is part of the draft strategy, which I think is under your remit, Minister. And so I just wonder again, are you able, or perhaps it'd be fair if I say, are you unable to tell the committee at this stage what half of the funding is and what the conditions are, and whether that will be a significant, a substantial lead time, despite the fact that this is in the draft biodiversity strategy? Is that the case?
And biodiversity colleagues are absolutely feeding into that process. So that process of agricultural reform is ongoing, and biodiversity is one of the parts of that. We're feeding into that, and officials and NGOs in that area are feeding into that process. But of course, there are others, you know, the farming stakeholders and other stakeholders in that space who are working together as part of that ongoing process to define what that 50% is and how that will work for farmers. So that is still underway.
Sticking with funding, the framework target 19 requires a significant upscaling of finance for biodiversity, and it talks about looking at leveraging private finance in particular. Part of the draft strategy is an investment plan. Perhaps Matthew Bird might be looking to answer this, but will that be produced, consulted on and finalised in the same time frame that we heard earlier about the plans and the strategy being finalised?
If you're happy to go on time frame?
Broadly, yes. I mean, that is the intention. There's a lot of moving parts in relation to that investment plan, obviously, yes, but yeah, broadly.
I'm going to press you, Mr. Bird, on broadly, because you told me earlier the delivery plan and the strategy was consulting in the spring-summer, and it would finalise, I can't remember your precise words, but I think it was around the autumn. The investment plan is very much part of that strategy, so is that going to be concluded in the same time frame, or is that likely to slip?
Well, I mean, if I can take you back to one of your earlier points, I mean, one of the reasons that we published the high-level strategy in a draft in December was so that the sector and the people who are delivering for biodiversity on the ground have that sort of indication of the direction of travel and the sort of steer that they need to start delivering for biodiversity already. You know, in relation to the strategy and the delivery plan, both of those are being delivered out of our team, and I can make that commitment. The Biodiversity Investment Plan involves bringing in a whole range of different partners to deliver it. So I'm happy to say that broadly it's being delivered along the same lines, but I can't be more specific.
In line with my earlier answer to the question that Jackie Dunbar raised, though, that doesn't mean that we haven't got started. As with the rest of the biodiversity matters, there are the two streams of the urgent actions that were already evidenced actions that we're already taking and the long-term strategy to join it up. And so it is also for the finance, where we absolutely will deliver that finance plan along with the strategy, but that doesn't mean we haven't got started. For example, we know that we know about our finance gap in natural capital. In 2021, there was a report from the Green Finance Institute which assessed our finance gap for nature in the UK, which is defined as the difference between the required spending and committed planned spending. So central estimates of our finance gap for the next decade are $20 billion for Scotland, which is about $8 billion for biodiversity protection enhancement and $9 billion toward climate change mitigation. So that is information that is already with us. I've already spoken about our Nature Restoration Fund, which is public money that is being put directly into that nature restoration. And of course, the member will be aware of the pilot agreement between NatureScot and Hamdens & Co. to invest in natural capital, which is a piloting this private investment, which we all know we need to bring into the sector so that we can fill that finance gap. And that is the first step there. So again, we have not waited to get started. We have already gotten started, but that strategy will still be forthcoming.
I'm very grateful. On that particular private finance deal that NatureScot has signed, I think it's around woodland for up to £2 billion. I find this a very interesting model, given, quite rightly, the Minister talks about the need for private investment in the £20 billion for forestry, woodland, but also given what we need for heat in buildings. Can we leverage private investment? Given the interest in that model, when does the Minister intend to publish the full detail underlying this deal so that we can see exactly what private investors are getting out of this deal and see whether it's applicable at scale and in other areas?
This is a partnership between NatureScot and Hamdens & Co. and is not something that the Scottish Government is directly involved in. So I don't have the information on when the information around that may be published on that project, but that's an ongoing partnership, so we can see how that works.
Will you commit to publish it, Minister, however, or could you come back to me with an answer as to whether it will be, and if so, when?
We certainly hope to gain learnings from that project, and I am happy to write to the member and find out to let him know what the timescale is for the learnings of that project being shared.
I wasn't asking about the learnings. I was asking about what investors get out of it and the detail underlying it. Will that be published, Minister?
I mean, as it's a partnership between NatureScot and private companies, I do not know what of that may be put in the commercial confidential space and what of that may be in the public space. So I'm unable to commit to the member on exactly how much of that may be able to be shared publicly. But I'm happy to commit to share the learnings from that project so that we can take it forward into hopefully other similar successful projects.
Minister, I understand your reticence about committing to do that, but it would be helpful, I believe, for the committee to receive correspondence from you just clarifying what you can share
Absolutely.
With us. And I note that the learnings are part of that, but if I think the member was specifically asking about what the deal involved, and we'd be grateful to hear if you can share that. And a written letter to the committee would be absolutely perfect.
Absolutely. I mean, I can give it a little bit more detail now, but happy absolutely to correspond as well. So the investment model that is being looked at here is based on a bridging loan from Hamdens & Co. to the landowner to create woodland, both through planting and natural regeneration, to bridge the gap between the initial investment and that flow of carbon revenue. So the carbon credits that will be generated, which can then be retired, so that's offset to collect those carbon credits. So that is the sort of general model, but yes, happy to write on more detail with what's available.
Okay, as you offered that, I think Liam wants to come in briefly back on that.
Very briefly, Minister, a bridging loan, what interest rate is that subject to then?
I do not have that information.
I truthfully, I think we've allow you to push that quite a long way, Liam. I'll maybe ask the Minister to write, because I think it is of interest. And I also think it's of interest to understand who will shoulder the obligations, because the loan will be a short-term loan to allow something to happen, but with long-term consequences and costs as far as managing the environment beyond that. So I think the committee would like to know more about that. So the more you can share with us, Minister, I'm sure the more grateful will we be. No, I'm going to come to Colette Stevenson, who in the cut and thrust of that lost her question, but I'm coming back to you, Colette. You're still muted. Hold on. You were muted. Start again. We hear you.
A very good morning to you all from a very snowy East Kilbride this morning. And thanks, convener, and a very warm welcome to the Minister and her team. So in evidence last week, the committee heard about a decision adopted at COP15, which takes forward aspects of the Edinburgh Declaration, which sets out areas for action for local authorities as well as sub-national governments, and recommends management of biodiversity be basically decentralised. So what role will local authorities need to play in the delivery of biodiversity targets, and how in practice can both local authorities and communities be more empowered in this area? And I'm keen to hear from you on that aspect.
Thank you very much for that question. I mean, that was the really interesting part about the Edinburgh process. I think you'll maybe all recall from COP26 how there was a frustration from subnational actors like Scotland, some of the American states, some of the European regions, that the parties, the members of the United Nations, may not be as ambitious as the subnational actors wanted them to be. So with the same concern was also present in the biodiversity space toward COP15, and that was why the Secretariat asked Scotland to lead this process for the subnational bodies. And it was really interesting in Montreal to get to meet. I met the mayor of Kunming. I met, I think, the deputy mayor of Paris. I met some amazing and interesting people from Sao Paulo, from America, from Quebec and from California, and to talk about what they were doing in that ambitious space. And the member is absolutely right. The regional governments have so much that they can do, because they're on the ground. They're at the coalface of how this actually happens. So I'm happy to kind of outline what some of the things that we're doing in that space. So we know that a lot of this stuff will actually need to be delivered by local authorities. And I do meet with COSLA regularly, and Nature Scott do work closely with the network of local authority biodiversity officers to work on these matters. With respect to funding, for example, the Nature Restoration Fund has a specific Edinburgh process stream, which is for local authorities specifically to take on projects. So we're applying direct funding to local authorities. There was £5 million of that in 21-22 and £6 million in 22-23. Another interesting initiative, I think, for local authorities in Scotland is our nature networks. So in October of last year, we announced an additional £200,000 for the expansion of nature networks in Scotland. So the vision is that local authorities will each have a nature network, and this addresses the problem of habitat fragmentation. So as human activity has encroached on nature, nature has retreated to sort of islands, if you like, which is a problem for resilience. It means species cannot move between them. It means they cannot keep their genetics healthy by intermingling. And it does mean that they are less adaptive to climate, because they cannot relocate or move as the climate changes around them. So nature networks are a way that we tackle that habitat fragmentation, and they will be delivered by local authorities in Scotland, which I think is very exciting, because that means that each local authority can decide for themselves what's going to work for them and what's right for them. And I'm really excited about or interested in the question of how we join those up at boundaries so that we can have this continuous network of nature throughout Scotland. So there's some really interesting work happening in that space.
Sorry, convener, can I just come back in?
Keep going. I'll stop you when we run out of time.
Thank you. Thank you. So I am proud and honoured to be home to Langlands Moss, which is one of the biggest peatland mosses in the whole of Scotland. And the volunteers there have done absolutely remarkable work. And there is like a lot of, in terms of biodiversity, Lorna, there's a huge amount of indigenous species there, which are at huge risk if we don't take action now, particularly the newt species. Can you maybe drill down and tell me what action's been taken there in respect of that? Because it is, it's a beautiful nature reserve there on the outskirts of East Kilbride.
Thank you so much for I think you're right to recognise the work of volunteers in this space for protecting and restoring nature. Indeed, I went to a very interesting, I think Matthew was with me on Thursday, which was the launch of the UK's Plant Atlas, where I think it was an estimated 8,500 volunteers went around the UK for over a 20-year period to count every flowering plant, basically, in the UK. It's an incredible achievement, and it is exactly that kind of data which we need to understand the challenges that the species that you are, for example, that you would have at the moss are under, and how much at risk our native species are. Unfortunately, that Plant Atlas shows that our native species are in significant decline, with introduced species on a significant increase. So you're absolutely right that the challenge is enormous, and those protected areas make such a difference. On specific species, as I outlined earlier to Ms. Dunbar, that one of the four streams in the biodiversity strategy under actions is to recover and protect a vulnerable and important species. So that's exactly the kind of focus that we need to have, that we are managing existing and emerging pressures for these species to continue the recovery, and where we need to, the reintroduction of these species. Lisa or Matthew may have specific notes on newts or...
It doesn't look like you're going to get an answer on newts, Colette. Maybe the Minister could write to you afterwards, or you could write to her afterwards on a specific constituency.
Yeah, no, we have no specific newt knowledge here, but we, yes, very happy to write to you on newts.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Okay, Colette, I'm assuming that's the end for you, so I'm going to move on to the next questions, which come from Mark Ruskell. Mark.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. So, Minister, I wanted to ask you about an issue which kind of cuts across to the other side of your portfolio, and that's about consumption. So we heard last week about some of the impacts globally on biodiversity of consumption and supply chains, and we recognise that that's reflected in the new global biodiversity framework, but it's also something which is reflected in our own environment strategy as well. So can I ask you about how the new biodiversity strategy and delivery plan will perhaps start to address the twin issues of understanding the impact of consumption on biodiversity, but then also what we do about it, given that, you know, there's a mixture of reserved and devolved competencies around that whole issue.
This is, of course, a very serious matter and a really big question. You're right that one of the outcomes detailed in our Scottish Government's environment strategy is that we need to be responsible global citizens and that we have to have a sustainable international footprint. If everyone on Earth consumed resources as we do in Scotland, we would need three planets. Our consumption relies on resources extracted or used in other parts of the world, including water, land, and biological and mineral resources. So our environmental impact, because we have such a significant one, doesn't just impact our own country, but actually extends far beyond our country. And the nature of that impact that we have because of how much we overconsume is complex. And some of the commodities we import are associated with deforestation, with water stress, and other ecological pressures. So as being good global citizens, we need to make sure that we are managing our own consumption here. And a big part of that, as the member rightly points out, is covered in the other part of my portfolio around that circular economy. We need to move to an economy where we don't tolerate waste. We don't tolerate waste of energy, and we don't tolerate waste of materials, so that we can reduce to a bare minimum that extraction that we do from the natural environment, and where possible, we are reusing those materials over and over again and using materials that have long life. And that's how we reduce that impact. As I touched on earlier, things like the impact of plastics on wildlife species, for example, and looking at how we manage plastics, how we reduce their use, how we make sure we recycle them when we do need them, is exactly, it's the how of how we tackle a lot of our problems in this space.
Mm-hmm. So would we expect to see something specific then in the biodiversity strategy and delivery plan around consumption going forward?
I mean, this is part of the cross-government work that we do. The consumption matters are going to be largely covered, I think, in my other portfolio under the circular economy bill and the route map for waste in Scotland, because it is about bending that around. But that doesn't mean it's not related to biodiversity. It just means, you know, these things are always artificially put in categories, but the member is quite right to point out that the work that we do in that circular economy space will be so important to biodiversity as well. So I'm absolutely confident that we will be referencing that in the strategy, because it's an important part of how we deal with it.
Okay, thanks for that. And can I just pick up one specific area in relation to consumption, and that's food waste. So, you know, we've noted that, that there's a particular target around consumption and reducing waste in that global framework. We've got that important target in Scotland to reduce food waste. So I'm just wondering how that's going and how we can make more progress on that going forward.
Yes, so conversations around food and food waste are absolutely ongoing as we work towards that target of reduction by 33% by 2025. So action so far has included running a school foods waste reduction pilot with Glasgow City Council, conducting food waste audits of over 100 hospitality and food service sector businesses, while NHS Scotland have been working with Zero Waste Scotland to tackle food waste in healthcare settings. We've published our waste targets route map consultation, which is on our ambitious waste and recycling targets, one of which is food waste prevention. Food waste reduction is a global effort, and we are signatories to RAP's world-leading Courtauld commitment to reduce food waste. And through that forum, we engage with UK's biggest food and drink businesses, other devolved administrations, and have access to best practice research and interventions. So a full review of progress against the commitments on food waste will be published this year. There was a bit of a delay to that during COVID. But we've also run two consumer and household-focused food waste reduction media campaigns since 2019, and we are providing £100,000 of funding support for Fair Share's Surplus with Purpose scheme in 2022, which follows on from £200,000 of funding in the previous years. Scottish potato supplier Albert Bartlett recently announced that they have redistributed the equivalent of 5 million meals through their Fair Share partnership, so that's a great success story. Mm-hmm.
Okay, could you just tell us then exactly when you anticipate that review on food waste to be published? Is that this year? Or?
Yes, we expect that to be published this year.
Okay, that's obviously something the committee will take a great deal of interest in.
Thank you, Mark. I'm going to come to the deputy convener for another question.
Thank you. Is the Scottish Government looking to other international developments in finalising the biodiversity strategy? Are there implications, for example, of the recently agreed the UN High Seas Treaty? And if Mary McCallan is the lead minister on marine issues, how is she influencing this biodiversity strategy? And also, for example, the development of the EU nature restoration law, how's that factoring into the final version or once going out for consultation with the delivery plan?
Great. Sorry, I'm just taking quick notes. So we took the UN high... so we had the high seas, EU... Right, we'll go through that. The Scottish Government welcomes the UN High Seas Treaty. This is a historic agreement which is now in place after over a decade of multilateral negotiations. So we've been at the forefront of ensuring protection from the high seas through the UK's membership of the OSPAR Convention, which has adopted a series of high seas marine protect areas in the mid-Atlantic since 2010. So our national Water Scotland has designated MPAs, which cover 37% of our waters. So And we're obviously looking at these 10% of waters as highly protected marine areas as we go forward by 2026. So I think we're already doing some excellent work in this marine space and absolutely welcome that work that's outside of our territorial waters. Because this has just come through, we haven't, of course, yet incorporated in, but because the strategy is still in draft, that gives us the opportunity to incorporate that new bit of work into our strategy as we go forward.
Can I just ask, is that Mary McCallan's area of responsibility or is it yours?
Oh, we're absolutely working very much together on this. So the biodiversity strategy covers many types of land uses, including forestry, including agriculture. So it isn't something that just myself is contributing to and working on. The ministers with the relevant portfolios are absolutely contributing on that as well. And indeed, the officials in that space, Marine Scotland, Nature Scot, and so on, work with all of us together. They're not sort of separated. So that is one of the nice things about having overlapping portfolios between myself, Ms. McCallan and Ms. Goujon, is that we very much are able to work together on these matters.
Because the UN treaty obviously is talking about 30 by 30 in terms of both land and sea, and my understanding is Scotland already has 37% of its marine area covered. So therefore, the sensitivity of that kind of making sure that we can live with the local economies, as well as obviously look at the marine protection, certainly on the inland areas, is of particular concern. And we know of the current concerns, for example, by West Isles Council on a marine protected area that has been proposed. So I'm not expecting you to deal with this today, because that's obviously an area for another minister, but I think we should register that marine spatial planning has to be very, very sensitive and sensible, and we'd be looking for a common sense view, but actually it will be a key aspect of what we'll be looking for in this biodiversity strategy, that it has that balance and that sharing responsibility that we heard on the land has to apply very much in the sea as well. Is that an approach that you would welcome?
That is absolutely an approach that I would welcome. I think that particularly in the sea space, it is not necessarily a sort of competing interests. One of the groups that I met when I was in at COP15 was the representatives from California, where they have had already for many years what they call no-take zones, which would be the equivalent of our highly protected marine areas. And when they implemented those, there was concerns by fishers about how that would impact their work and their business. But actually what they have found there is that their no-take zones allow for species to breed and thrive uninterrupted, which actually improves their yields in terms of being fishers as well. So this isn't necessarily an either-or thing. The member is absolutely right that we need to consult and make sure we put these in the right places, that stakeholders, you know, are absolutely engaged in that and communities. But I don't think it's necessarily the vision that these things are in conflict, that highly protected marine areas where you have a no-take zone do give the fish that place to breed and thrive and increase their numbers, and as they then move out from those zones, they're available to fishers. So this can actually be an advantage that works for everyone.
Okay, I would suggest that the West Nile situation is a bit of a conflict zone just now in terms of what we're hearing, but I'll leave that one there just now. I also referred to the EU Nature Restoration Law. Is that something that you'd be looking to keep pace with in terms of what they are doing to make sure that the biodiversity strategy embraces some of that thinking as well?
Yeah, absolutely. So the Scottish Government has already committed to maintain broad alignment with EU's environmental standards, and we've been monitoring with interest the developments in the EU's ambitious nature restoration law. And in fact, our strategy sets out the metrics that we would use to measure the targets as they have set out. At the moment, the EU law and targets are proposals, and they're subject to negotiation between member states and amendment by their parliament. So our approach at the moment is to, again, we're not waiting for them. We're developing our own targets and delivery proposals, but we will take account of what's going on in Europe as those developments emerge.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Deputy Convener. Looking around the table to see if there's any other questions. No, I've got a couple of questions then for you, Minister, if I may. Are you happy with the use of carbon credits and them being attached to land across Scotland?
As the member will know, and as we will have heard in the evidence session last week, there absolutely needs to be mechanisms for bringing in private finance and investment into this space. So, you know, carbon credits are an established tool, and there's work being done on biodiversity credits and so on. So these are, you know, I guess they're sort of under development, but the the finance that they bring in is absolutely needed. There's no question that we must have private finance to develop in these areas, and that is one of the tools for bringing in that finance.
So would you be happy to see parts of the land and estate owned by the Scottish people through the Scottish Government being used to generate carbon credits and finance for the Scottish Government?
I don't actually have any particular comment on that. I'm not aware of any particular work in that policy space. No.
But you don't have a view on it. Has it been discussed at all? It seems quite fundamental with, you know, the forestry estate that we have, that whether the government should be considering it or discounting it.
I'm very happy to take that under consideration. I can write to the member on that point.
So they haven't discussed it?
That may not be the case. I am not aware of those discussions, but I can certainly find out and write to the member on that matter.
Okay, just I'll bring Mark in. Just can I ask one more question on that, come to you? And my concern is that carbon credits come with a sting in the tail, because you don't know what the ultimate cost of those carbon credits is going to be. But it appears, if firms are buying up or giving bridging loans, it may be for carbon credits, which is an interesting concept. And therefore, I find it odd the government hasn't discussed it and discounted it or agreed that it should be done.
I mean, what the member refers to there is the Nature Scot agreement with Hampden's & Co, which is, it, as the member suggests, is an investment model based on a bridging loan from Hampden to a private landowner to support that private landowner in creating woodland, which bridges the gap between the initial investment and that flow of carbon revenue. So that is that is a way of helping private landowners do that woodland regeneration.
I absolutely understand it, but help comes at a cost, and I'm trying to identify if the help is attached to carbon credits. Mark, I'll bring you in and then maybe follow that up a bit more.
Yeah, I actually wanted to go back to the issue about marine protected area designation, because...
Can I finish on my carbon credits thing and then come back to you on the marine protected areas?
I'd be very grateful, Convener, if it could.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. Okay, so just pushing that a little bit more, we've seen large tracts of Scotland change hands at very high prices to allow firms to attach their carbon output to that land by getting a carbon credit. It has caused some concern. Does it cause you concern, Minister?
Certainly the matter of green lairds does cause concern to myself and certainly to my ministerial colleagues as well. It is really important that we balance the need for investment in our natural capital with work that we're doing to empower local communities as well, so that we do not have this situation of problematic green lairds. So there's a suite of existing measures in place to mitigate the impacts of this rapidly evolving market. For example, in the last Parliament, we implemented legislation to extend community rights to buy, including the right to buy land to further sustainable development, and to introduce a new register of persons holding a controlled interest in land. So at that time, fears were raised that our measures would deter inward investment, but as the member knows, that has not been the case. As we can see from substantial land rises in land values that have happened in the last few years. So I share the member's concern around the so-called green lairds and that kind of land. So this is why we're putting in place these frameworks for ethical investment in land and nature restoration and private finance.
Just for the record, I am surprised and concerned that the government don't have a policy on carbon credits and their land and whether it should be the right way of generating capital. I'm not expressing a view on it either way. I'm just concerned that there isn't a policy on it, but I'd be very interested to hear. I'm going to come to Mark, and then Mercedes wants to ask a question. So Mark first.
Yeah, I just wanted to go back to the issue about marine protected area designation, because one of the long-standing concerns that has been from environmental NGOs, also communities as well, is that we designate protected areas, but they might end up as paper parks because of a lack of enforcement and monitoring. I'm just wondering what your response is to that and how we might ensure that highly protected marine areas going forward are adequately, we have the right management measures associated with that and that the enforcement is there as well.
I mean, the development of highly protected marine areas is still underway. We're doing that consultation to, you know, as the member rightly points out, get those in the right places, because there are certainly challenges there in terms of making sure that we've engaged stakeholders at all the key stages when we're locating and when we're selecting the sites for these highly protected marine areas. In terms of the enforcement of HPMAs, so the MPAs and HPMAs are different beasts. MPAs will have marine management plans in place which say how that is to be used. HPMAs are much, much stricter in terms of being no-take zones and the restrictions on commercial activities in those spaces. So the details of enforcement of those, I may have to get Lisa or Matthew to support me on the exactly details of how those would be enforced.
So I think there's a number of enforcement challenges that's recognised because of the significant area that they cover and the large number of fishing vessels that there are. My understanding is that effective compliance is going to be carried out by extending the requirement for vessel tracking and monitoring systems across the whole commercial fishing fleet by the end of the current parliamentary session. And I think we recognise that illegal activity in MPAs is caused by a small number of operations which really casts a shadow over most of the law-abiding fishing community. But if further detail is required, I'm happy to obtain that from the relevant officials and provide it.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks. Mercedes, I think you wanted to come in with a question.
Yeah. Thank you, Convener. Yeah. It was just in response to, Minister, your point about the need to address green layers, and you seem to suggest that part of the work to do that involves increasing community right to buy. But of course, the carbon credit model has the inadvertent consequence of increasing the price of land. So then communities are priced out and they're even more reliant on government funding to buy land. So it strikes me as quite a short-term solution to go down the route of a private financing model. And that in the long term, it increasingly prices out communities and the public from land. And so I suppose my question is, would it not be more prudent to adopt a community wealth building model, which uses public funding but locks that into the local area so that the whole community and then by extension the country benefits, rather than potential, you know, overseas private finance companies?
Well, as the member will know, maybe the member wasn't present for the evidence session that came to this committee, the need for private finance for nature restoration is unquestioned.
It's
There's
debatable.
Absolute consensus on that.
It's ideological.
The finance gap there is £20 billion. There is absolutely no way that can be fully funded from the public purse. That simply isn't possible. So what we need to do, and this is what we're working on doing, is putting in place that framework for ethical investment in these places. And that does, nature restoration, and that does mean managing those different interests and making sure that that does incorporate the community wealth building and the, you know, local input into those schemes. But we absolutely cannot meet our targets for climate and nature restoration without private finance. That simply isn't possible. So we have to find a way of doing that ethically that does support communities.
Thank you. And I think this is an interesting subject which will continue to vex us. I think the problem is short-term gain could come at a long-term cost, whether it's be for individuals, communities, or whoever has sold the obligation and takes it on. So I think that's a very interesting question. We have, Minister, come to the end of this session, so I'm going to suggest a pause till 10:35 before we go into the next session, which I'm sure will be equally interesting. So I therefore suspend the meeting at this stage for 10 minutes. Thank you. Welcome back. Our next item is an evidence session on Scotland's deposit return scheme. And I refer members to the papers they've received in this item. At the committee's last meeting on the 7th of March, we agreed to take evidence from the Scottish Government on the DRS and to also hear from the Circular Scotland, the scheme administrator, at a meeting in the near future. The purpose of these sessions is to ascertain key information about the scheme's readiness for launch on the 16th of August this year. I'm pleased to welcome back Lorna Slater, the Minister for Green Skills, Circular Economy and Biodiversity. I'd also like to welcome Kevin Quinlan, the Director of Environment and Forestry, and Ewan Page, Head of UK Frameworks. Before we begin, Minister, I believe that you'd like to make a brief opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener. I welcome this opportunity to address the Committee on Scotland's Deposit Return Scheme. When we launch DRS on August 16th, the scheme will be among the most environmentally ambitious and accessible in Europe. It will increase recycling rates from 50% to 90%, reduce littering on our streets by a third, and reduce CO2 emissions by 4 million tonnes over 25 years. We are at an advanced stage of preparation for launch, with much of the infrastructure for the scheme already in place. Approximately £300 million of private investment has been made. Counting and sorting centres are being created, vehicle fleets have been ordered, and recruitment is underway. As of March 10th, 671 producers across the full range of drink producers, from global brands to small craft breweries and distilleries, representing 95% of the total volume of drinks containers sold in Scotland each year, have completed registration for DRS with Circularity Scotland. I am delighted that so many producers have already stepped up to the challenge to take responsibility for the waste that they produce. The scheme will also create 500 jobs across the country, with 140 new jobs at a recycling plant in Motherwell and 70 jobs in Aberdeen already announced. This month, we have also seen the launch of registration for return point operators. This includes supermarkets, local shops and other outlets where customers can return their empty containers and reclaim their deposit. We previously updated guidance and support to make it easier and quicker for retailers wishing to apply for an exemption to being a return point. This was in response to direct feedback from retailers, particularly smaller retailers. Exemptions can be sought on proximity, that's where an agreement has been made with other nearby return points, and also on environmental grounds, for example, if there's not enough space to store returned containers. I recently wrote to the convener of this committee to provide an update on the work undertaken to secure an exclusion from the Internal Market Act. As set out in that letter, UK government ministers acknowledged that the Scottish Government has followed the agreed process at all times. I will take this opportunity to again confirm that we have been following the agreed and established process between UK government and devolved governments for excluding certain areas from the Internal Market Act since 2021. We expect a decision from the UK government as soon as possible, and I will continue to keep this committee updated. I will continue to work collaboratively with Circularity Scotland and businesses as they finalise their operational delivery plans and we move closer to the launch date in August. I welcome the opportunity to assist this committee in its considerations, and I look forward to questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister. The first question is going to come from me. In my 6 years in this Parliament, I don't think I've ever come across legislation which has caused this much problem as it's being introduced. So what is the problem as you see it? And then I'm going to ask you how you're going to solve it.
I actually think that the problem is largely one of misunderstanding of what the scheme is and how it operates. The scheme itself is moving toward launch. That milestone of 95% of the market by volume being signed up for the scheme is the big milestone. This is a producer responsibility scheme. That means that producers of the materials that we're collecting in this scheme, the people who profit from these materials need to ante up. They need to put it on the line and say, yes, we are now going to be responsible for collecting these materials, for sorting them, and for making sure they get recycled properly. This is a big shift from using public money to do that work to putting it back on the producers. And for the producers in that volume, that enormous number of market volume, which represents, as I say, 95% to who have signed on the dotted line and saying, yes, we are stepping up, we're doing that. That is a huge milestone. The next significant milestone is this, getting the return points signed up. And then from that point, once Circularity Scotland and BIFA know where the return points are and how many items they expect from each return point, they can then finalise their collection schedules and so forth. And Circularity Scotland and BIFA are working toward that August 16th launch date. So all of those pieces of the puzzle are underway, and that is what we need to get the scheme launched. I know that there are still some concerns from some small producers about how they participate in the scheme, and we are working with them and SEPA and Circularity Scotland to bring them on board so that they can continue to supply the Scottish market.
Okay, so if in your own words, the biggest problem is misunderstanding, somebody's failed to explain it to the people who are concerned. Have you got enough time to explain it to those people before the launch in August?
The communications between Circularity Scotland and SEPA and businesses is ongoing and is underway. I think some of the frustration is that things that are being reported in the media and the press are simply not accurate. And the correct way to get the right information is to go direct to Circularity Scotland to get the information that businesses need. So we are both signposting people to that organisation, but that organisation is also employing a communications expert to support the communications with businesses. They've been holding workshops all over the country with businesses to help them understand the role in the scheme. They have an excellent website. They have call handlers who can answer phone calls and emails at all hours of the day and night. So any businesses that are not clear about their role, instead of reading something on Twitter, what I recommend that they do is get in contact with Circularity Scotland and get the right information that they need.
I'm not sure businesses base their decisions on Twitter, but on the fact that the misunderstanding is at business level, my next question is I think the public has signed up to getting deposit returns working, but when you go to a supermarket, as I did on Saturday, to buy some bottled water, 24 bottles, small bottles of water, costing £3, that's going to become £7.80. That's quite a change to my shopping basket and everyone else's shopping basket. Do you think the public misunderstand it, or do you think they fully understand what's coming down to them?
Whenever the public are asked about such schemes, they are always very, very enthusiastic about them. They generally have broad public support. These schemes like ours work very well in other countries. It's very straightforward and well understood. And in fact, people in this country often are nostalgic and have memories of similar schemes from when they were young and returning their bottles to get their money back. The cost when you buy the bottles is added to the cost of 20 pence per each bottle and can, but of course you can get that back when you return those materials, so that is a net neutral cost to the consumer when they purchase those materials.
And I'm nostalgic about returning other people's bottles as well, which may have been fraud, but I'm sure somebody will come on to that in the questions. Next question is from Mercedes Fiaba. Mercedes.
Thanks, Convener. Minister, I've got some questions around producer registration. So the initial deadline was the 1st of March, is that correct? Yeah. And to extend that would require a change in regulations, is that correct?
To extend that deadline, however late applications are being accepted.
Okay,
and so we are not, that's not been a hard cut-off. Businesses can still and continue to apply.
And until when will that continue?
I mean, that is indefinite in terms of any business who wants to sell in Scotland in any particular year needs to be signed up by March 1st of that year. For this year, for the first year of the scheme, that we are allowing late applications to support businesses to come online with the scheme. Any businesses that aren't registered in time for scheme launch will not be able to supply in Scotland. So we do encourage them to get going. However, in future years, if, for example, there's a new startup business in Scotland and they wish to sell into the Scottish market, they would also need to apply for the scheme. So as new businesses come into the Scottish market, they can sign up for the scheme on an ongoing basis. So that they can sell in Scotland as well.
So next year, will the 1st of March be a hard deadline, or will it be that every year it's just as
I believe that the regulations have that March deadline every year in the regulations. That's to allow time for the business to be operationally included. But as with this year, I believe that late applications would still be applicable. The intention is not to be punitive to businesses. Businesses need to sign up for the scheme. They need to give that information over of how many products they have and the labelling. Basically, so it's time to program those reverse vending machines. So when you take your bottle or can back, it'll scan the barcode and say, yep, you bought this in Scotland. This is a scheme article. Here's your 20 pence back. From when you register, the point of registration is to sort of go, here are my barcodes, here's my products, and then we have to go and program all the vending machines in Scotland to be able to take those back. So that is why there's a sort of deadline for that, to allow that time for that work to be done. So that's why businesses need to register as soon as possible so that their barcodes can be registered with the machines.
And I understand there was consideration of a potential grace period for small producers. So are we now in that, or is that still something that you're considering?
We're looking at a variety of measures to support small producers. So as I outlined in the answer to the other member, although we have hundreds of producers signed up, there are some producers that have not yet signed up. And we're looking at digging into the detail of what the challenges there are. Circularity Scotland, in response to conversation with those producers, have already put into place considerable cash flow measures for those. I think it was £22 million worth of cash flow measures to reduce upfront costs, really help with that cash flow, because that was identified as a barrier. Another thing that was identified as a barrier was labelling. So if you're a small producer, getting your bottles redesigned with a different barcode, there are minimum order quantities for that kind of thing, and it takes a long time. And to remove that barrier, Circularity Scotland will be issuing sticky labels to producers when they have less than 25,000 of any particular product, can just get those labels from Circularity Scotland, so that they're kind of already pre-registered because the labels have been issued to them. So those were two.
So would
very
that be instead of the producer being required to register? Would they need to register to get those sticky labels?
They do need to register, but they can go through the process to get those labels. So because it was identified that redesigning their packaging on the timescale was a barrier to them. And so Circularity Scotland came up with this really practical labelling solution so that isn't a barrier to them. So going forward, we're looking at what else do we need to do in terms of those producers who have not signed up? Do they understand the package measures on the table? Because I know you took evidence from...
I think there will be questions later on about labelling, and particularly for small producers. So if you wouldn't mind if we could stick questions around registration just at the moment.
But I mean, that is what we're looking at, is understanding what the barriers to registration are. So one of the things that some small producers asked us to consider was a grace period. So that was not a grace period for registration. They still need to register. That would be in hypothetically a grace period for implementation. There are some big challenges around that. Not just that is maybe not fair to medium-sized producers. It's not fair to those small producers who have signed up. So what I think we need to do is take a step back again. We know that hundreds of small producers have signed up, so this is clearly not a universal barrier. So for those businesses who haven't signed up, we need to look at what the challenges there are and make sure we're putting in place the right measures to help them get on board.
And so the deadline to register has passed, but registrations are still accepted. And so if it gets to the 16th of August, which is the launch date, producers who haven't registered by that point, does that mean they will not be permitted to sell their items in the Scottish market?
That's correct. That's normal for how these schemes work.
And are you considering a grace period for that point from the 16th of August, or is that's a hard cut-off, but up until the 16th of August there's time to register, or would you still allow registrations after the 16th? Can producers sell their products if they're in the middle of the registration process after the 16th of August?
So the date of the 30th of June 2023 is the final date that SEPA needs to assess and receive completed registrations. So they have to be completed by that point, which means that I would highly encourage all producers to start their registrations before that point. So the registration process is reasonably detailed, because you've got to put all your products in and the details of your barcodes and so on. And SEPA needs time to process those applications and publish the register of producers before the scheme goes live on August 16th. So, for example, if you're a retailer and you carry various products, you need to know which of those products you can continue to carry by the 16th of August. So SEPA needs to publish that list going, right, here's all the producers, these are the producers who can continue to sell in Scotland so that they're complying with the legislation. Now, what SEPA have said and that I support them in is that they will be very pragmatic about how they're going to implement that. Because what we want to do is make sure that businesses are on a pathway to compliance. And that's what we're in discussions with in terms of when I say we're looking at how we can bring small producers on board who have not yet registered, is working out what that pathway to compliance looks like for each individual business. Because each business is quite different and has different requirements and barriers. And we don't intend to be sort of, you know, punitive or coming after businesses. That's not the idea. The idea is to support businesses to comply with the scheme, because we do want businesses to continue to be able to sell in Scotland, and we do want businesses to understand their obligations under the scheme, and in fact to make best advantage of it. Because clearly, if you're registered with the scheme and you can continue to be stocked, that is a competitive advantage for you.
And finally on this topic, so if a producer registers after the 30th of June, would that registration be considered for the following year? Because you said the deadline is the 1st of March each year, or could that then be processed to get their products onto the market in the current year?
I would have to look at that situation, what exactly, I mean, happy to write to the member on that with the details on exactly that would work. For, I mean, there clearly has to be an ongoing process of business registrations, because of course new businesses start up all the time. Yeah. So clearly that's necessary, but exactly how that will work and what the delay is between registering and being able to sell in the Scottish market, I'm happy to write to the member on that detail.
Thank you very much.
Minister, just to remind you, write to the committee if you wouldn't mind.
Sorry, write to the committee. Thank you very much, Convener.
And I think that is fairly critical, because if there's hard deadlines and they can only join at a certain stage during the year, it may stifle business. So an answer would be grateful.
Thank you, Convener.
The next question comes from the Deputy Convener, Fiona Hislop. Fiona.
Yes, I'd like to address return points and particularly the issues facing small convenience retailers. Who have concerns about limited space and also lack of capital revenue to invest. Now, you've addressed that to extent. There's two issues, I think, in terms of health and safety and also the distance to another return point. So what engagement has there been with the independent convenience store, different organisations and groups? What are their concerns? And to what extent has there been, or at what point will you know that convenience retailers are either, establishing a return point in their own premises, or choosing to opt out? At what point will we know this?
Okay, so the member asked some really good questions there. Circularity Scotland itself is a not-for-profit organisation. It's a private company that is not-for-profit that is made up of members, and within its membership are the trade associations assorted with small convenience stores. So the Association of Convenience Stores, the National Federation of Retail News Agents, and the Scottish Grocers Federation are all members of Circularity Scotland. So they not only have a direct line to the information, but they are also influencing the decision-making that Circularity Scotland has. So that is the mechanism by which Circularity Scotland interacts with those convenience stores, is through their membership of their trade associations. I, of course, meet with these associations regularly, particularly Scottish Grocers Federation. So the concerns that they have flagged up to me particularly were there's sort of two categories of them. One is they've emphasised this to me, they very much want their members to be able to participate in this scheme, because they consider this a matter of footfall, that where small grocers participate in the scheme, that means people are coming through their doors, which is exactly what they want. So what they have asked me for is, help us be involved in the scheme. They're very supportive of that, so that's really helpful. The other thing that some small businesses were concerned, particularly ones that are tiny, that don't have storage space, as the members pointed out, or, for example, maybe a bakery that does sell bottled juice, but also baked bread. You can't have broken glass in a bakery. So as the member points out, there are exemptions for that. So let me just give the high-level picture so everybody understands. There are three things. If you sell bottles and cans of juice in and wine or anything else in Scotland, you have three options. You can choose to be a manual return point. You can choose to have be an automated return point, which means installing a reverse vending machine. Or if it's applicable to you, you can choose to be exempt. So the grounds for exemption are proximity. So example, if you have several small stores together but a big store over there, the small stores may go, do you know, I'm just not up for being a return point. Can we ask the big store to take our returns? But equally, they may go, do you know, we want to work together to be a return point. All the small stores, we're going to pool together and we're going to get one reverse vending machine. So there are different models, and it's up to each business to decide how they want to do that. So the other two options are, if they do want to be a return point, they can be either a manual return point, and that's if they're collecting, that's most cost effective for business if they're collecting small amounts. So that's probably what a convenience store would do, because if they have small floor area, they may not have room for a reverse vending machine, they may not have high numbers, they would take those back as return. So you just hand your bottles and cans over the counter and do it that way. Reverse vending machines, that infrastructure is probably most appropriate for bigger stores that not only have the space for them, but then have the capital to do the upfront installations and the, you know, the resource to do the administration of getting the planning permission and all those things that go together. So if you think about it, it's likely big stores will have the reverse vending machines, small stores will have those manual return points, and then businesses that apply, which will again be small businesses or businesses that have bakeries and so on in them, will be exempt. In terms of how we know, at this point, it's with those businesses to make that application. So return points applications are open. So businesses can look at that evidence and they can decide what to do. And then once the period of applications for the return points is complete, we will have a picture of how many return points we've got in Scotland, and we'll know the mix of whether it's how many are manual, how many are RVM and so on. And then we'll be able to calculate, knowing how much volume of material out there, estimate how many will go to each point, and that will allow BIFA to then work out its logistics. Because of course, if there's more return points, that's fewer items per return point, fewer return points, more, and so on. So working out the logistics does depend on exactly how many businesses sign up, where they are, and what their volumes are. So that is very much an iterative process where we see what businesses have signed up. I hope I've answered the member's question. Yeah, I may have drifted off of it.
When will we know?
When does retailer registration close? I think retailer registration closes.
Pardon me.
Sorry.
Don't touch the button. It'll
happen. Thank you, convener. It's an ongoing process. Okay, it's a rolling process.
So you can register any time. I think what that means also, though, is if businesses are not sure they will be ready for August 17th, if they haven't decided, they could apply for an exemption, and it's applicable to them, they could apply for an exemption. So say a small cafe thinks, oh, I can't deal with this year, I'll apply for an exemption. They could then reapply at a later point to be a return point. So that is not a permanent decision.
Okay. And then clearly Scotland is a country that has vast rural areas, island areas, small convenience stores in villages, small towns, etc. And I think there's also the concern about having a return point. And I understand this iterative process, and that obviously the logistics here, not least for BIFA for collection, are such that there might be few and far between in terms of collections, etc. And that's what people might fear. So what assurances can you give? And is this for Circularity Scotland, or is this something, as a minister, you can make clear that you want this scheme to work for all parts of Scotland, not just urban areas, but also semi-rural, island and remote communities as well?
The member is absolutely right. This scheme has to work for every single person in Scotland, because every single person in Scotland will be paying their 20 pence, and so every single person in Scotland needs to be able to easily and conveniently get those back. That's absolutely how this scheme is intended to work. So the exemption process, the way that works is, at the moment, it's an opt-out process. So by default, all businesses that sell these containers are obliged to be return points. So any convenience store in a small town or an island and so on, where you can buy these drinks, also has to be a return point unless they're exempt. So it is absolutely the intention that this is the mechanism by which, small rural areas or remote areas, because the same place you go to buy your juice is the place that you would return it to. And those proximity exemptions are much more likely to apply either where you've got a group of shops close together or, as you say, within an urban area. So that proximity exemption wouldn't apply in a rural area where you've only got the one shop, for example. Certainly, Circularity Scotland and BIFA are very conscious of, we call the industry term is black spots. And as the registrations for return points come in, they'll be monitoring that very closely and engaging with any businesses that appear within a black spot to make sure that we do have adequate return points. And I believe BIFA is even looking at the possibility of mobile return points to collect from very rural areas.
Okay, so that's probably an issue we should be pursuing with Circularity Scotland about the practicalities.
Absolutely, they'll be able to get into the nitty-gritty of that.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
There's a lot of SUPs here. I'm going to go to Liam first and then come to Jackie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning again, Minister. On that exact point, I think the Deputy Convener's questions were really pertinent. And it seems to me that the suggestion is that if I'm a retail outlet and I can't afford a reverse vending machine or I have no space for it, then according to the ACS graphic that I saw recently, I would put the returns in bins behind the counter. Now, what if I have no space for that? What if I'm in a rural area so I can't avail myself of the exemptions that you've just been talking about? And is that really right for the health and safety of staff?
I mean, that is how these schemes normally work. When you're a return point, you need to take the bottles back and then you need to store them until they're collected. So that is the case. What I understand is that when you register to be a return point, you enter in the data of how many returns you expect and how much storage space you have, and that will allow BIFA then to put in their schedule how often that you need that collected. But yeah, that is normal. They will need to be able to store those materials until they can be collected by
BIFA. It might be normal, Minister, but the question I asked was, what if I don't have the space for the bins behind the counter, and in any event, is it what we should be doing for staff?
When we return items, they will need to be stored until they can be collected. Businesses already, have storage within their businesses for various recycling materials and packaging materials. This is very similar, but it's absolutely going to have to be up to each business to figure out how they can store these materials. Businesses do have an obligation to be a return point if they're selling these materials, unless they are exempt. And BIFA and Circularity Scotland are very happy to work with businesses to find out what that works for them. Storage, I mean, there's no particular rule about how they have to store these, that they can adapt it possibly behind the counter. I've also seen some versions of that where people have designated wheelie bins that are secured in a secure area, for example. So I think there are, there's a variety of ways to adapt that kind of storage, and businesses can make the right decisions for themselves.
But on that security, these bins will have value. So do you recognise, or is there a risk of crime being associated with open bins being stored behind counters?
Well, the member is correct that the items do have value and so will need to be kept securely, because the shops themselves need to return those items in order to get their fees back. So they do need to secure those items. I mean, they're only 20 pence each in the sense of what the value is in a shop in terms of what's kept behind the counter in a shop, bottles of alcohol and tobacco and so on. They represent only a small value of what's in the shop. But the member is quite right that these items will need to be secured until they can be picked up, because they do have value.
Okay, Jackie.
Thank you. If I can, in regards to the exemption that you were speaking about, in regards to the business return points, you were saying that they can apply for an exemption and then change their minds later. But if they don't want to change their minds later, can I ask how long an exemption will last for? Do they have to reapply every year, or once they've got an exemption and is that for a certain period of time?
As far as I know, that is until they wish to end the exemption. I'm not aware that there's a time frame on it, but I'm very happy to come to back to the committee, with clarity on that if that is not the case.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jackie. The next question from Mercedes.
Thanks, Convener. Minister, I've got a couple of questions still around the return point operators area. But looking at the adjustments that have been made. So to begin with, can I just clarify, so the return point process, the exemptions for return point operators, that's an opt-out process currently. Is that correct?
Yeah. Return points do need to register to be a return point, but that's largely so that they have an obligation to register. Anyone who sells these materials have an obligation to register, but that's so that they can enter in exactly the detail that Mr. Kerr was pointing out in terms of how much storage they have, in terms of how much volume that they expect to receive, so that the logistics can be organised. But and yes, if you wish to be exempt, you need to apply for an exemption, and it's Zero Waste Scotland that are managing that exemption process.
Yeah, and so return point operators, they might be eligible for an exemption which they can opt out of. And if that was to change to opt in, that would require a change in regulation. Is that right?
No, they just need to then apply to be a return point operator. That's fine.
I thought you said that there was an obligation for everybody automatically to be a return point operator and that you would have to opt out.
Those exemptions were built into the regulations. That's not new. That was already in there. What we did is streamline the process to make that more straightforward for businesses to apply for that. So we've brought in Zero Waste Scotland as our partner on that. So there's no change to the regulations. Basically, this was just how we're just implementing it in what we hope is an easier and more practical way.
So there've been some calls from some parts of industry to make it an opt-in process, that you opt in to become a return point operator rather than opting out if you're eligible for exemptions. So I'm just trying to establish, but if that change were to be made, it would require a change in the regulations. Is that correct?
Yeah, that would. I mean, but I don't think that we need that because when I speak to, for example, the Small Grocers Federation, what they are saying is help us facilitate our members to do this. We want our members to be in, they want the footfall.
And so the rationale
I'm not hearing strong calls for it to
be
an opt-in system. The obligation remains for anyone who sells these materials to be a return point unless they're exempt and apply for an exemption. So the exemption process, where we've made it as sort of simple and as streamlined as we can, now that businesses are starting to use that process because the registration is open for return points, I'm sure they'll give us feedback and hopefully we can continue to make that more simple and straightforward so that it's really straightforward for businesses like, do you know what, I'm exempt, it's for health and safety reasons, I'm not comfortable handling glass in my premises, I'm going to apply for an exemption, that they can do that in a straightforward way.
And so presumably the rationale behind that is that if you are a retailer, you would want to be part of the scheme because shoppers looking to make purchases will, for ease and for simplicity, they're more likely to choose to go to a retailer to do their shopping where they can also return their empties. So it's just easier process, not having to go to one place to return another place to shop. So I can see the rationale for that. And I just wondered if you could maybe explain the rationale for having that same opt-out system for exemptions for the hospitality sector, because it seems like that's a different case whereby if you are... I'm not sure that the ability to return an empty item would influence customers when making their choice of hospitality venue in the same way that it would for a retail business, if you see what I mean. So are you able to just explain a little bit of the rationale behind having that opt-out process for hospitality rather than opt-in?
I mean, it's the same process, so all return points have the same process. Now, hospitality falls into two different categories, and this is going to start to get horribly technical on you. There's closed-loop hospitality and open-loop hospitality. So if you're thinking of like a small cafe where you maybe it's your local Greg's Baker, and you go in and you get your sausage roll and your juice in a bottle there, you're going to then take that away. That's an open loop. So under the scheme, that means that business, because you're going to be taking away that bottle, is an open loop. So they are obliged to be a return point unless they're exempt. But a small cafe or Greg's Bakery, for example, have probably got a very clear grounds going, you know, I'm a bakery, I can't have broken glass in here, I'm exempt. So that business would probably apply for an exemption on health and safety grounds, which means that they are not operating as a return point. Equally, it might be that small bakery is in a parade of shops with maybe a larger convenience store down the end, and they just go, do you know what, I'll speak to them, they'll take my return points, and they would get that exemption on the basis that in the same parade of shops, that's your return point down there, and they can make that choice. So that choice is with businesses to make the right one for themselves. The other type of hospitality venue is a closed loop venue, and that's where you're maybe at a restaurant where you order a bottle of wine for your dinner, but you don't take the bottle away with you, however much you may wish to, to leave that venue. And that is closed loop hospitality. So that bottle does not incur a deposit because you're not taking it away. However, the venue itself will have paid a deposit on that when they bought that from their wholesaler. So they need to get their deposit back. And that is through this closed loop system where BIFA will come and collect those materials separately, but it doesn't affect the consumer. So that we start to get into sort of technical things, but that's two different ways that hospitality venues can manage.
Am I right in thinking that closed loop hospitality venues are obliged to be return point operators unless they opt out?
No, that's not right. So closed loop hospitality, they are not return points. Yeah, so a restaurant that only serves, you know, drinks to their table and doesn't give you the ball is not obliged to be a return point. But that they're not obliged to. But that sort of cafe or a small bakery where maybe you get a sandwich and a drink and leave the venue with that, they are obliged to. But as I say, those venues are likely to have grounds for an exemption.
But if you're at a bar or a cafe, closed loop system, you will
you're not obliged to be a return point.
Thank you. And so I understand that there's been a couple of adjustments. Adjustments made to the return points guidance. There's new guidance on exemptions, increased handling fees, proposed amendments around online sales. So it would just be helpful to hear to what extent those changes have addressed industry concerns that you've been receiving. So is the Scottish Government still receiving concerns from businesses? Can you tell us to what extent those adjustments have helped?
So can you repeat the middle one? You said exemptions, and the third one you said was online sales. What was the middle thing you said?
Increased handling fees.
Handling fees, right. Okay. Yeah. So all of this work has been done exactly in response to industry requests. One of the interesting things about this project is that the legislation as passed by the Scottish Parliament was relatively broad, and that was to allow industry to come up with the solution that they wanted. So this is an industry-led scheme. Now, you'll, of course, there are kind of two major halves of this. One is the producers who have to pay into the scheme, and the other half is the retailers who have to actually implement the scheme, because it's them that will be selling you your bottle and taking it back. So you can imagine that there are push and pull in this relationship, because the producers want to pay in as little as possible. Of course they do. And the retailers want to be paid as much as possible for the work that they're doing. So that is an internal negotiation that happens and that Circularity Scotland is managing to manage those tensions within industry. Specifically the exemptions was around the small businesses who said, we can see your exemptions in the regs. How does that mean for us? So we've put in place this process with Zero Waste Scotland. It's on their website. And as I say, that's now active. The handling fees and the producer fees have also been addressed in the last few months. And that was because Circularity Scotland made some initial calculations based on initial estimates of what those fees might be. And industry came back and went, please think again. And so they did. They, with the exemptions process in place, that meant that they could change their modelling about how many return points there would be, and they were able to adjust those figures. So the producer fees have gone down and the return point handling fees have gone up. And because Circularity Scotland itself is a not-for-profit organisation, they don't keep any of that money. All of that money goes to reducing the cost of the scheme. So, you know, the idea is that as the scheme beds in and becomes more efficient, and you know, as we get past that sort of day one costs and so on, then the idea is that those fees can be revisited in line with that more efficiently running scheme as we go forward. The last point that the member brought up there was about online sales. So that was that is in the regulations. However, it was flagged to myself and my colleagues so strongly that the online obligation as written in the regs just simply was not deliverable. And businesses have said, you know, that they can get on and deliver a more traditional scheme like what we have in other countries, which is based on reverse vending machines and manual return points. But the online take back, which no other country does to the extent that we had put into our regs, just simply wasn't going to be possible on the timescale. So that's one where I've heard business and said, you know what, you're right. That I can see that that's not going to be possible on the timescale. So we have committed to removing that obligation from the regulations. So those regulations will come for amendment to Parliament, removing that obligation for online take-back and phasing it in for larger retailers starting in 2025.
Minister, just before we move on, I've got a quick question, just so I understand this. A lot of rural areas have one small convenience store, which will sell convenience goods. Most people use it on an ad hoc basis, but go to the bigger towns and settlements to get their messages at a weekend and bring them back. So there's no other shop in the village, so there's no proximity, so they can't get away from being a deposit return scheme. They can't argue environmental health because there is no environmental health, they're just selling it. So they're forced to have a deposit return scheme, and they will be forced to take containers from the big shops, where most people get their shopping at the weekend, into the little shop, which means that they're going to end up with a storage yard probably as big as the shop. Is that the way you see it, or have I completely misunderstood that?
One of the things that we have yet to see is how consumer patterns manage. Will people do a bit like they do with bags now, you know, since we've got the 5p charge, where they keep the bags in the back of their car and take them with them when they do their big shop on the weekend? So it's actually a concern that's been raised with me by small retailers that people will do that they will take all their bottles back to the big shop and therefore not do the footfall in the small shops. So it is yet to see exactly how that pattern will work out so that we understand the exact volumes that each business will get, because consumer behaviour is something that we will need to observe and adapt the system for. However, there is a proportionality clause in the regulations whereby small, especially manual return points, can refuse. You know, so if someone ramps up with a van full of cans and tries to return it to a small shop where they haven't got the space, they can turn those away. They're not obliged.
I think
to.
I understand that. I think that my point is you're not going to take your cans in your containers back on the bus to get your shopping at the weekend. Much easier to pop them into the local shop before you go. I think it's a problem, and I'm just interested about that.
I mean, right. This is common for these schemes around the world. That's normally how they work.
Common to replicate problems.
Common where both the local shops and the big shops take returns so that the consumers can decide where they want to return them.
Liam, yours are the next questions.
Yes, thank you, Convener. I'd actually like to follow up on an earlier question the Convener raised, and that one just there. The Convener talked earlier on about the cost of a basket, if you like, the cost of the shopping. We know that DRS could add, let's say, up to 40p per unit. Given the cost of living crisis and the increase in cost of the weekly shop, has the government investigated, has the government done any research on what impact this scheme might have on inflation?
The research that we've done on this is in, you know, looking at schemes around the world and similar schemes, and the deposit itself is fully refundable. So it does not add to inflation, because when you pay your 20p, you get that 20 pence back again.
I said up to 40p. Minister, you were talking about the 20p being cost neutral, but we know that there are other costs that could or perhaps will be factored into this, which are not recoverable. So I ask again, very clearly, has this government got anything that I can read that can be published that shows the impact of on inflation of this scheme?
Is the member asking about what costs business may add,
because
the deposit itself is the 20%, 10, 20p that, you know, you pay and then you get that back in, so that's neutral. I mean, what businesses charge for their products is not a matter for the Scottish Government.
Minister, has the Scottish Government done any research on the impact on inflation of the DRS scheme in Scotland? Yes or no?
The member will recall that we've got the BREA that was done before the legislation that was passed, which talked about the impact and economic assessment of that. So that work that was done was fully documented at that time.
In 2019. I wonder then, going on to the convener's other question, the point he just made now, I was quite concerned by the minister's response. So the direct question, has the government got any data or has it done any investigation on what impact adding up to 40p per container will have on consumer purchasing behaviours, such as the type of products, the format of the things they're buying and the like, or have you not modelled what impact this scheme will have on consumer behaviour?
I don't recognise the member's assertion about 40 pence. That is not a number that I recognise, and it's not a number that is, in terms of the cost of the scheme, it's 20 pence and you get that 20 pence back. But in terms of the consumer behaviour and format switching, we do not think that there will be extensive format switching, for instance, from small units to large units in order to reduce any perceived markup in the deposit. As I've noted repeatedly, the deposit is fully refundable and retailers are required to display that information showing that deposit is refundable. I mean, there's lots of other deciding factors for consumers, such as practicality, convenience and brand preference and the presentation of the product. So evidence suggests where product or format switching has occurred in other countries with DRS, it's rare that it can only be attributed to DRS. So we think that there really will be only limited impacts in this respect.
Will you publish what it is, the evidence that you've put together, that collated, that leads you to come to that conclusion as to what you think?
I'm happy to share with the member what information we've got on format switching.
Very grateful. Final question from me in this section, Minister. The many small independent businesses have suggested that they are disproportionately impacted upon, and some have suggested that the viability of their businesses may be at risk when this scheme comes in. Minister, were these concerns factored into the Scottish Government's initial impact assessments such that they were known about and the Scottish Government knew these would be concerns? Or are these concerns new to the Government?
Is the member referring to concerns from small retailers or small producers? Because, of course, one is in receipt of fees and the other pays the fees.
I'm concerned about both, but the point that I'm making is many small businesses, whether producers or retailers, have suggested their businesses are at risk from the DRS scheme. Were these risks known about and factored in by the Scottish Government when it was putting this scheme together, or have these concerns come as a surprise to the Government following the implementation and publication of the details of the scheme?
The scheme that we've got in Scotland, as passed by the Scottish Parliament back in 2020, is very much in line with schemes around the world. So in terms of nothing is a surprise, what we're doing here is exactly along the lines of what is being done in other countries. I'll address the producers and retailers separately. So on the producer side, the intention, of course, is to be fair to all producers, to have a fair scheme, but it is absolutely a proportional scheme. Fees to the scheme are based on, sorry, I've got to get the data in front of me. It is proportionately because producer fees are charged for each individual container. So it will be proportionate inherently to the size of business. So a small producer like a craft brewery will pay significantly less than a larger producer. Now, the additional cash flow measures that Circulary Scotland announced, I think it was it 2 weeks ago now or 3 weeks ago now, are benefit all producers, but proportionally small producers more. So this is when we pass the regulations in Scotland, we passed something that was similar to other countries, and then it is up to the businesses themselves, as I discussed when answering the other member's question, to sort of manage that push and pull between the producers who pay in and the retailers who take those fees.
So let me just be clear, Minister, because I asked you a very direct question. The Scottish Government knew then, from what you're saying, because you looked around the world and you looked at what was happening elsewhere, the Scottish Government knew that small retailers would be disproportionately impacted and some businesses' viability would be threatened.
That is not what I said at all.
You didn't do that?
What I said we're doing is, our scheme here,
I know what you're doing, Minister. I'm asking
other...
you a direct question. Did you know that small retailers would be disproportionately impacted and their businesses would be threatened, or did the Scottish Government not know that?
I don't agree with the member's representation there that small businesses are disproportionately impacted. The measures we put in place have been to support small producers particularly. And I can go through those again. The measures we put in place to small producers specifically to support them. One of them is this proportionality of producer fees so that small producers have the same proportionality as large ones because it's per individual container.
Sir.
Equally, there's the cash flow measures which specifically help small producers. In terms of small retailers, our fees for manual return points are the highest in the world for our small retailers. So our small retailers, those who operate those manual return points, are better off than their compatriots around the world. So we are doing more for small businesses with our scheme than other schemes around the world which are highly successful. So I do not agree with the member's representation of that at all.
Okay, thank you. I think that's taking that as far down there as it's going to go. More questions from the Deputy Convener, Fiona.
I'd like to ask about the March Gateway review. Is that currently taking place and who conducts that?
Absolutely. So we have had, let me find my Gateway review section. We have had, as you know, several Gateway reviews on the project. There is currently one underway this week, and we will get the results of that imminently. The Gateway review teams normally speak with 12 to 15 interviewees, including relevant commercial and external stakeholders, for example, prime contractors and consultants, the people who are actually doing the work, and they will, you know, give their assessment, and we'll get to find out exactly how they think we're getting on.
Who does the Gateway review?
So the Gateway Review basically is a panel of independent people. Deputy Convener, the current person who's leading it, has led previous reviews, and he is supplemented by an expert on IT systems and another expert looking at finance and governance issues.
Thank you. I know there have been previous criticism that there had not been international input into Gateway Review. My understanding from government Gateway Reviews, that wouldn't be normal in any case, and any international research and any international comparisons would have happened at the very start of the legislation and the regulations. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Yeah. So in terms of the March Gateway Review, I think it's going to be fairly critical in terms of understanding how fit for purpose and ready the scheme will be. So will it be published to enable scrutiny? When will it be published? And how will progress be monitored and you know, decisions taken in the run-up?
Yeah, I agree with the member that we definitely are awaiting with interest the results of this review. So we're going to consider carefully the recommendations from the review, and we will share these and its response with yourselves, with the committee, in due course.
So can you give us any advance of in due course? What kind of time frame would we expect to see that?
I don't have any further information on the time frame of that. I don't know if we can commit to any time.
It's probably not for me, but I can take up the second part of your question, Deputy Convener, which is how will it be monitored? How will we take forward? So there's a whole range of different measures there. We've got a system-wide assurance group, which brings together CSL, SEPA, and Scottish Government. That meets monthly. We also have an executive oversight group, which meets monthly. The Minister meets with the CEO of CSL monthly and others as needed, and every Monday, I sit down with the CEO of SEPA and CSL and their teams to monitor progress.
And for the purposes of this Parliament and this committee's scrutiny and accountability, it would be helpful for our planning if we got some indication at some point soon as to when we might expect to see the Gateway Review published, if you could agree to do so.
We'll do what we can there. Thank you.
And then just finally, will that Gateway Review identify if there are sufficient and adequate resources for SEPA and Zero Waste Scotland in particular, because they're obviously a key part of the scheme?
We'll have to obviously wait for what that Gateway Review comes up with. The previous Gateway Reviews had given us the steer, for example, for streamlining the exemption process. That was an instruction or a bit of advice that came straight out of a Gateway Review that we were then able to go and implement along with their guidance. So the Gateway Reviews are very constructive, and they're very detailed in terms of saying, look, here's where you've got some challenges, here's what's going well, and here's something you can work on, and then that enables us to take that away, which we, as I say, have done on previous Gateway Reviews. So we're all looking forward to seeing that, and hopefully we'll have some constructive input for us.
As we will. Convener.
Thank you very much. It would be helpful to have the idea of timescales for the Gateway Review, as the Deputy Convener has asked. Mark, you have some questions.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I think it's been useful to get clarification on a number of areas this morning, but I wanted to look forward. I mean, it is a very ambitious scheme. It's what the Parliament voted for. It would be unthinkable that there wouldn't be some teething issues post-August in terms of the operation of the scheme. Has there been any thought as to what those issues might be going forward? I think you mentioned, Minister, this morning, you know, there'll need to be continual analysis to make sure that there's adequate return points And you know, that will be a role for CSL to continue to do that. I'm just wondering, looking forward, can we anticipate any kind of issues that may arise, particularly on the basis of international comparisons, and how CSL might deal with those?
Absolutely. So the scheme as it looks on August 16th this year is probably going to look quite different than the scheme, for example, 18 months down the line. So when a scheme like this launches, the first stage after launch is what we call the cutover period. And that is always a challenging period, because at that point, when you start to sell those scheme articles from the shops, most of what you have in your house, most of the litter that's on the street, for example, they are not scheme articles. So from August 16th, if you go and do your citizenly duty and pick up a can from the side of the road and take it to a return point, it will get rejected on that day because it is not a scheme article, because it was sold before the date. So there will be a period during this cutover period where there are some scheme articles in circulation, but quite a lot of materials that are not in circulation. And it will take some number of weeks for scheme articles to become predominant. So a big part of what we have to manage is this ramp up into the scheme. Now, there are tried and tested ways of doing this and learnings that we can have from other countries, because that is a challenging period where we have to make sure our consumer comms is clear so that customers understand why it is that this bottle they bought on the 17th can go back, but this bottle they bought on the 15th can't. So that is definitely a challenging period for us to manage, because we all want people's first experience of the scheme to be a positive one, for their bottle to get accepted and to get the 20p back and use that voucher to shop. So or that 20p to spend as they wish. So absolutely that cutover period is critical. What we will also start to see as those materials gradually ramp up is what consumer behaviour looks like. As Mr. Mountain points out, does the consumer tend to bring things back to the big shops? Do they use a mix of small and large? How does that work? So that means that BIFA and Circularity Scotland are going to need to be very reactive and dynamic. I'm very much hoping that they'll and we'll be working with them to put in processes such that a small business who says, oh my goodness, my bins are full, BIFA, come and get them, have a mechanism for doing that and have a mechanism for updating. So they're saying, do you know what, I thought I was going to get 10,000 items back a week, I'm actually only getting 3,000. You know, we need to adjust our schedule and so on. So there's going to need to be a period of adjustment and optimization as the scheme settles in. So I would absolutely expect that to be the case. I can absolutely anticipate already there may be communities going, but there's not a point that's convenient to me. How can I get that? I haven't been able to get collections. There will be some of those sorts of issues which we will need to be dynamic. So it is my intention to kind of facilitate a sort of reaction force to this, so that people know who to call, businesses know who to call when they say, look, my bins are overflowing or I can't return this. There'll be a sort of process by which they can say, right, here's how I find out how to get my 20p's back. But the scheme will ramp up and adapt over the first year. And indeed, the targets that we've set for their recycling, I think, come into effect. I think it's after a year or 2 years to hit those. I'll have to get corrected on that. But when it is ramp up, with the recognition that it's not going to be 90% recycling on day one, as the scheme beds in, we will work towards that 90% recycling target.
Yeah, and that's a clear target for CSL to be aiming for.
Right.
A clear driver, is that right?
That's right. And they are under statute obliged to return that level of recycling. So in terms of the black spots and the collections and stuff, CSL have to have this comprehensive network of return points to enable that, to allow them to hit those points, because they can be penalised as an organisation if they do not meet their statutory obligations there.
Okay.
Mark, just have you finished on the teething issues? Because there's a supplementary on that before you go on to your next ones. I'm very happy.
Yes, I realise we're going to move on to a different area in a minute. I mean, I was just going to make the point, Camille, I think it's important, Circularity Scotland, that we've got an opportunity to question them in the weeks ahead as well, because there's some real nitty-gritty stuff in here, which it would be good to get some evidence on. But yes, if you have
Liam has asked a question on teething, and then we move come back to you, Mark.
I'm very grateful, Convener, and to Mark Ruskell for letting me in. I saw, Minister, one trade association warning that around 40% of products could disappear from shelves in Scotland. Does the Scottish Government recognise this as a possibility? Is this what happened in other countries when you were looking? And if so, is the Scottish Government taking any moves, or is there something you can do to counteract this?
We already know that 95% of materials by volume are signed up. So in terms of the counteraction to this, any risk, is to make sure that we bring producers online so that they can continue to sell in Scotland. So all those measures that we're doing to support producers to sign up to the scheme, including cash flow measures and labelling measures and any further measures that we agree with them, are exactly that, to allow that variety of producers to continue to sell in Scotland. The labelling one is particularly of interest when it comes to the importation of wines, for example. That was a specific ask from our wine importers, because you can imagine the difficulty if you're only importing 500 bottles of wine from a vinery in France. They're going to go, I'm not putting a Scottish label on that, quite reasonably. And so that's exactly the kind of thing where this labelling was designed for. And our estimate is that about 15,000 products will use that sticky label solution. So it is absolutely not the vision that our products are restricted. We are working to make sure that we continue to have a wide variety of products on the market.
So just for absolute clarity, you don't recognise that warning that 40% of products will disappear.
Know.
Thank you.
Thank you. Back to you, Mark.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. So I wanted to go over start to ask some questions. I know others want to come in on this as well, just around the UK Internal Market Act exclusion. And, there are questions there about process and who asked what and when. But I just wanted to start off by asking you about scenario planning. So if there isn't an exclusion under the Internal Market Act, what happens then? What is the consequence of that? How do you plan for that? So could you start with answering that one, please?
Yeah, I mean, I think that is premature. And the Scottish Government has been and continues to follow the agreed process for excluding the DRS regulations for the Internal Market Act. So that exclusion, Ewan is the absolute expert in this, but I'm going to give you what I've got on this, and then Ewan can add additional detail. The exclusion isn't just one of these things, the whim of the UK government or not. The exclusions for the Internal Market Act are agreed under frameworks. The framework is an agreed process by which the devolved administrations and the UK protect devolved matters. So the waste and resources framework is there to protect the Scottish government's ability to legislate in devolved areas. And under that framework, we put together the evidence and case that this matter, which we are considering, which in this case is our deposit return scheme, is fully a devolved matter, which it is. It clearly is a fully devolved matter, and we have presented that evidence through the agreed process to the UK government. So that's the stages that we've gone through to get to an exclusion. Ewan will be able to add so much more detail than I've got.
Thank you, Minister. I think the Minister set the very well. I think it's probably important for the committee to keep in mind that the exclusions process that's agreed with the UK government and the other devolved governments was expressly designed to avoid this rather binary Scottish government asks, UK government decides model that has characterised some recent comments. The common frameworks are agreed into governmental structures that predate the Internal Market Act and were designed to move this into a more collaborative, evidence-based space. And one of the many issues with the Internal Market Act was the threat that it posed to the viability of the operation of common frameworks. So the fact that late in the day we managed to the UK government brought forward an amendment that would allow for policy divergence agreed through a common framework to not be subject to the market access provisions in the Act is very welcome. We're nearing the end of the process. The common framework has indicated that an exclusion should be granted. That recommendation is now under consideration by ministers in all the UK administrations. The other point to make clear is that UK ministers and UK ministers alone are the only actors in the system that have the powers to give effect to that exclusion, as the Act confers the necessary powers only on UK ministers. Mm. So the matter will be under active consideration by the lead minister, the Secretary of State for DEFRA, and we expect an answer very soon. But this is not a question of... It shouldn't be looked at as a stage of we submit an application and it's either approved or rejected. We expect things to move in a predictable, transparent and evidence-based way. And we're confident that the case has been made clearly and collaboratively with UK government through the Common Frameworks process. Okay.
So I'm getting words of reassurance there about the process and about how the Common Framework has been working and continues to work. However, there's still a potential threat that the exclusion isn't granted. So what happens then?
Well, as the Minister has pointed out, we're not thinking in that way at the moment, because were that to be the case, without any further reasoning or reference to the evidence that's been gathered through the Common Frameworks process, that would represent a very significant threat to the agreed Common Frameworks process that we have in place, where we collaborate as equals in that space with UK government and the other devolved administrations. So the repercussions would be significant for a key plank of intergovernmental structures that have been put in place since EU exit. And one of the, you know, frankly, rare examples of things progressing quite well, that they have created a space for more collaboration. So where we'd see a situation arise where there was UK ministers declined to use the powers that they have to give effect to an exclusion, we would need to understand with urgency how they came to that consideration, how they came to that view in light of the Common Framework recommending that an exclusion should be implemented to remove the confusion and uncertainty that the Internal Market Act is causing.
So just to clarify or sum up that point then, so the recommendation has been for the exclusion has been made on the basis of evidence. In rejecting that evidence would be out with the how the framework is intended to work. I mean, if that was the case, as Ewan suggests, that would be a very significant breakdown in the collaborative working of the two governments, well, in fact, of all the devolved governments. So if that were the case, given the sort of big deal nature that would be, then the Scottish ministers will set out our next steps at that point.
Okay.
Thanks, Mark. Colette, sitting very quietly there, your questions now.
Yeah, Mark's kind of touched upon it, and thanks, convener. One of the minister really considers the resource and waste common framework and process for agreeing the new exclusions from the UK Internal Market Act to be fit for purpose based on the lessons that to date, that in relation to both the DRS and single-use plastics, so including how the provisional common framework might need to be amended to reflect much more recent developments that we've heard of today.
Yes, I'll give my view and then I'll hand over to you, and who, of course, is the expert in this space. But I think the resources and common waste and waste common framework has worked well. For example, we used it last year to get the exclusion that we needed for the single-use plastics ban. As long as the framework is being used as intended, I think it is working well. I guess the question on the table is whether UK ministers will break that framework, will break that agreement. Ewan.
Thanks, Minister. A couple of observations. Common frameworks, as I noted, predates the Internal Market Act. There was agreement at the JMC European negotiations in October 2017 to embark and work to agree these intergovernmental structures to manage by agreement some of the practical regulatory effects of the devolution settlements no longer operating in the context of EU membership, and that includes UKG legislating in devolved matters for England. The frameworks process is underpinned by a set of ministerially agreed framework principles. These include an agreement that common frameworks will be used to ensure the functioning of the UK's internal market while acknowledging policy divergence, a very, very important point, a recognition that in any internal market, there is always a balance to be struck between market efficiencies, trade flows, and the preservation of the rights and responsibilities to make rules locally that are fit for local circumstances. So it was a very unfortunate development when the internal market bill was introduced. There was a great deal of concern from not the Scottish Government, Welsh Government, parties in the Northern Ireland Assembly, wide agreement amongst academic and legal commentators in many sectors that the Act posed problems, not least in how it would interact with the intended operation of common frameworks. In effect, it removes the incentive to try and manage these processes by agreement if there's an automatic application of the market access provisions in most relevant cases. And the Act is very, very unusual. It's not like other internal market regimes elsewhere. It's very rigid in its application, and it also has no countervailing proportionality principles underlying it. So that's part of the reason you see this propensity for confusion and lack of clarity, because there's little you can do to temper and balance the broad requirement to maintain mutual recognition and non-discrimination in all cases. So common frameworks have started their operation in not the most auspicious of circumstances. We have, as I say, that late amendment to the Act that creates a little bit of space for common rate frameworks to operate as intended, and we had some welcome commitments from UK ministers as to how that will be used, which presupposes a degree of automatic flow from an agreement being reached on a common framework to manage, to agree to policy divergence and to manage that, to seek an exclusion from the Internal Market Act as required, and UK ministers subsequently using the powers that only they have to give effect to that exclusion. So it's important not to chuck the baby out with the bathwater here. There are lessons to be learnt about the operation of common frameworks. These lessons are made more complex and challenging by how we manage the interaction between common frameworks and the Act, and they are in many ways, if not incompatible, very difficult to reconcile approaches. But we have the opportunity to do so, and I think it's an added reason why it's very important that we see this process run as intended through to the granting of an exclusion in this case, to give greater confidence that the Common Frameworks programme has space to operate as intended.
That's a very detailed statement there from you. Rather than go back to you, and I'd like to see if Colette wants to come in. Sorry, go back to the Minister. I'd rather see if Colette wants to come in with a supplementary for the Minister based on what she's just heard.
Yeah, just quickly, and thanks, Convener, for that. And it was a very detailed response, so thank you for that. But just in terms of the exclusions process, do you think there needs to be a clearer definition of what form a request for a new UK Internal Market Act exclusion should take? How should that look?
I mean, I think the question here is that there is no request. That's not part of the process. The process has been agreed, as you outlined, in terms of that common framework and the process for it. This isn't a question of requesting and being accepted or rejected. This is a question of working through that framework to present evidence and then working with that evidence. So I think it's very unfortunate that, for example, Alistair Jack has presented it this way in the media. That's not accurate. That's not how this works. And, you know, for the record, Alistair Jack has not attended any of the IMG meetings where we have discussed this matter. He has not corresponded with me on this matter. He doesn't know how the framework works. And so his comments on it are unfortunately not very helpful.
So with the greatest respect, we've been trying to keep this very apolitical, and I don't think it's the right place in the situation to call somebody out, in the same that what we've been trying to do is to understand the mechanics of the operation today. So I'm very happy to let you conclude, but I try and take the personalities out and avoid making criticisms of people, as we've agreed to do in this committee as well.
I understand, Convener. So I think that the way, as Ewan said, the Waste and Resources Common Framework is the right structure for this, and it isn't helpful to frame it as a request and accept or decline. That is not how the process works. It is an evidence-based process for decision-making.
Thank you, Minister. Liam's asked for a supplementary, and I've got a very quick question at the end, Minister.
Thank you. Just very briefly, Minister, on the practicalities. Mercedes Vialba, I thought, asked a very salient question around hospitality earlier on. Now, as I understand it, Biffa are the only logistics operator in the scheme, so hospitality venues will be required to work with Biffa. Are you able to tell the committee why that contract wasn't put out to tender? But in any event, and perhaps more crucially, what happens to existing contracts that venues might have with other waste management companies when Biffa come in to take over?
I mean, the first part of that question in terms of the contract with Biffa, Circularity Scotland is a private, not-for-profit organisation. So as a private company, their procurement procedures are entirely their business and not for government to be involved at all. They're not a public company, so their public procurement procedures do not apply to them. In terms of existing hospitality logistics. Certainly, I know that CSL and Biffa are keen to use existing infrastructure where possible and where companies wish to continue to be involved, you know, wish to be involved in the scheme. CSL and Biffa are encouraging those infrastructure providers to contact them about how they can be involved. The overall goal of this scheme is to produce more and better quality recyclate. So that does mean collecting the scheme articles. They do need to be separate, as the member has noted. They are value and have a separate value. That doesn't mean that encompasses all the recycled materials that hospitality venues will deal with. There will be other containers, for example, other glass containers, other plastic containers, which are not scheme articles. And those materials will still require collection. And indeed, with the scheme articles taken out of the system, it's true for local authorities and for private providers, that opens up their bandwidth and capacity to collect other materials. For example, I think we can all see that collections on things like soft plastics, that more work could be done in pots, tubs and trays, these other kinds of materials. So this should broaden out our ability to recycle across the spectrum, as well as increasing it specifically in scheme article materials.
Thank you. And we're running short of time, Minister. Just with both of our agendas, just a very quick question. I was interested in your comment about small producers out with Scotland, maybe, who are producing and selling some goods in Scotland, but not much of their thing. I'm just trying to understand. I think you gave the example of wine coming in, but, you know, if one of the big multiples wants to get a small producer in, and Circularity Scotland are going to give them the labels to stick it on. I don't understand what the process of sticking it on. Is that by one of the retailers just before it goes out the door? Is it on the point of when they're imported into Scotland? How does that work? Surely that's going to add cost and reduce choice.
I mean, those labels are provided free of cost from Circularity Scotland to businesses to whom that applies. So that means that the people who are importing small quantities or indeed producing small quantities don't have to come up with bespoke labelling. So that does, you know, bridge that gap. In terms of the actual organisational detail of at which point that's put on, because of course materials often pass through multiple wholesalers and retailers and so on, I would have to come back to the member. Or indeed, when you have David Harris here, I think in 2 weeks, that sort of operational detail would be a good one to ask him as well.
And I'm sure that is a question we'll ask, because I'm sure that some of the big multiples want to get down to sticking on labels and normal convenience stores for small quantities of product. It's been a very interesting session, Minister. Thank you very much for your time. And I'm sure there'll be further questions from the committee with Circularity Scotland, who I think are coming in on the 28th of this month to answer questions. So thank you very much. I am going to continue on, Minister, because we have one item further in public, and I'm sure you'll be able to slip away quietly, as it were, as we move on to that. So The next item is agenda item 5, which is consideration of a negative instrument, the Roadworks Reinstatement Quality Plans, Qualifications of Supervisors and Operatives and Miscellaneous Amendments, Scotland Regulations 2023. The instrument is laid under the negative procedure, which means the provisions will come into force unless the Parliament agrees to a motion to annul them. And I have to say that at this stage, no motion to annul has been laid. Do any members have any comments on the instrument? So can I suggest that the committee agree that it doesn't want to make any further recommendations in relation to the instrument, and are we agreed on that? So we are agreed on that, and that's the way it will be. So thank you all. That concludes our public meeting, and we'll now go into private session.